Being a couple minutes past 7, I'm going to open this meeting. I'd like to remind everybody that the meeting is being recorded tonight, as well as televised, I guess. So. Okay, our first order of business tonight is the recreational marijuana bylaw public hearing. Are we able to read a public hearing notice, or do we have it?
Oh, yeah.
Put a second motion to waive it, but.
I think, would you like me to? Notice is hereby given that under the provisions of MGL Chapter 40A, Section 5, the North Reading Community Planning Commission will hold a public hearing on Tuesday, February 21st, 2017, at 7 p.m. in Room 14 of the North Reading Town Hall, 235 North Street, for the purpose of considering an amendment to the Code of the Town of North Reading zoning bylaws to prohibit licensed recreational marijuana-related businesses. The proposed amendment does not propose changes to the zoning bylaws currently in place regulating registered marijuana dispensaries selling medical marijuana. The complete text of the proposed amendment is available for inspection at the Community Planning Office at North Reading Town Hall, 235 North Street, North Reading, Mass., between the hours of 8 a.m. and 4 p.m., Monday through Thursday, and 8 a.m. to 1 p.m. Friday. Published in the North Reading Transcript, February 2nd and 9th, 2017.
I would like to defer to Mr. Prisco. Would you want to make a presentation from the Board of Selectmen on this?
I first want to apologize. I was not paying attention. So can you just...
All we did is read the public hearing notice.
On the marijuana?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay. And could you tell us what the Board of Selectmen's position is on this?
Yes. So, reading the papers and watching some of our meetings on NORCAM over the last month or so.
The discussion about marijuana has actually been taking up most of our meeting time, recreational and medical. And as we've been discussing the medical, I think everyone kind of knows where that is right now. The discussion of recreational came up, and it was pretty clear across the board, the members of the Board of Selectmen, that we, as a board, are not in favor of recreational in town. We felt that it's just not right for the town. And if you go back and look at the results of the vote for the recreational marijuana, it failed in the town of North Reading, but it won overall for the state. So we felt that since the majority of the town was against it, we as a board don't want it in town. We felt that we should take advantage of the law as it's currently written. And based on town council, we have the right to go ahead and put this warrant article in to prohibit recreational in the town of North Reading, and then we'd take that to a ballot vote in May. And we'll take advantage of this special town meeting that we have on March 13th to do that. And that's, as you see, if you have in front of you the warrant article, and that's what our ultimate goal was. And Kate, you want to present any more on that? Or I think I summarized it, and I believe it was unanimous for the Board of Selectmen in support of that warrant article. And I think that's really all I have. Do you have any questions for us?
Any comments from the board first, and then any comments from the board at all on this?
Not at this time.
Okay, I'm going to open it to the public for questions then. please state your name and address when you ask a question, and address all your questions through the chair. Are there any questions from the public on this? Yes.
Have you used a microphone, Warren?
I just wanted to ask if you guys could speak up.
Okay. Well, you should have speakers here, so I don't know if we can.
Yeah, I'll go closer.
Curtis, you've got it. Okay, are there anybody else from the public would like to ask questions on this? Yes, sir.
One question maybe we can ask, but I'm not. I'm against it.
Thank you. Kelly from the Board of Selectmen. And the legalization was enacted by the state. So even though it's still prohibited federally, there's state regulations in place permitting this, and the opt-out provision of the regulations allows us to say no to sales in North Reading. So at each town, it has the ability to, each city or town has the ability to opt out. And we heard from a number of people just in the context of the medical dispensary hearings stepping forward regarding recreational and their desire to see to it that we prohibit the sale in North Reading. So I think that's, you know, you heard from Mr. Frisco, that's why. There's really no answer directly to that question. No one really has given any sort of specific guidance, but the federal can still come in and enforce the federal regulations, but different states have enacted it to permit the sale in their own state, so it's yet to be determined what happens.
I didn't realize that state legislation superseded federal legislation, so you know, this whole thing strikes me as strange the way it operates.
Well, technically, I don't think that it does, to be honest with you, but
states' rights.
There's so many states now that have enacted this legislation and allowed and up to and including their recreational, that it's very difficult to see how the federal government takes their stance. But it almost it harkens back to Revolutionary War days when the states had all the power and the federal government was very weak. I mean, and that was kind of the way our forefathers had it figured out. States do have some pretty powerful rights, and this so far the federal government has not interceded in any of these states that have allowed this. So I think it's a bridge yet to be crossed, and I agree with you that there should be something. The federal government should either recognize this or at least remove the stipulation to it. If this is what the states want, they do have their rights. Yes, Kate.
I think just one more thing to add too, that if we don't step forward and attempt to what we're trying to do via the bylaw and the ballot measure, anyone can come in and sell anyway. We don't regulate it by prohibiting it too. So I think that was an important piece of why the board, like Mike said, wanted to do this now.
Yes, Mike.
Just one quick Mr. Frisco added to that. You can see though the disconnect between the federal and the state on this is another reason why we should take this action now and take advantage of this ability to opt out, because we don't know what's going to be coming down the road. This openness now to marijuana, it seems to be gaining a lot of speed. We had Senator Tarr here for our last public hearing regarding the medical, and he did say to us that he thinks we're going down the right going in the right direction with this, the step we're taking tonight and what we plan to do in May. And he has no guarantee where it's going to end up. Even if we do this and we enact this, we prohibit it, down the road, it may get superseded anyway. So let's take advantage of what we can, because it gives us a chance to take a deep breath and to take it all in, protect the town in the meantime, while the legislation is battling this out and getting the details worked out.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Prisco. I agree to a point but we could also do a 1 year moratorium, which is another thing that many of the communities have done, enact a moratorium on making a decision on that. Because the thing that bothers me about it is that the state hasn't even finished. They don't even have a final rule yet. And what that is, as you mentioned, could supersede anything you do right now. So it may be that a moratorium is a better step, because it doesn't put us in line for what might be, similar to the medical marijuana. If we'd have denied that, we would have been in line for a suit, because the state mandated that we allow that. So there is always that possibility that they could also say freedom, that the freedom to do this is inherent in the law because of the vote of the people. I believe in this town it was a 48-52 split. It was pretty close. So again, you could run into some opposition. Whereas in a moratorium, which will buy you approximately the same amount of time, maybe a little more actually, you might have a chance to see what the state's really going to do and maybe make a more informed decision at that point. That's my feeling on it. Okay.
Just a clarification, too, on our position on this. If the CPC elects to take that stance and to go in that direction and not go forward and not support this warrant article, perfectly fine. The Board of Selectmen are going to then take the step, and we're going to take this article over, and we're going to process it forward if the CPC elects not to. I just want to let you know, because we talked about that. We talked about doing the moratorium, but we felt pretty strongly that we should take advantage of our position now, because we may not get another one. And I think the ones that don't do it, I think, are actually taking the risk. I see where you're coming from, and we've had a lot of debate on it, but I'm only speaking for myself personally. Mrs. Minipelli can chime in if she'd like to, but I just want to make sure you're clear what the Board of Selectmen position is on this, and I don't think I've misrepresented our position.
And I just think the one specific in the legislation is the ability for each community to opt out, which is the path that we've embarked upon, is creating the bylaw and then putting it to a vote to see what the people in the town want to do with it. So we're actually committed to that one specific thing in the legislation that guides us as to what we can do right now.
Yeah, thank you. It does say that it would have to be by a vote, by actually an election style vote, in order to bring this forward. So I don't think we've made any decision on it. We keep reading the information from town council, and there's a little wiggling room in there, you know, which makes us wonder exactly, you know, where they're really coming down on this. So I think we're going to take a little longer look at that, and that probably make our recommendation at town meeting, make sure that we've got as much information out of them as we can. Is anybody on the any more questions, any comments or questions from the public? I'm going to close the public hearing and ask one more time, is there any input from the board at this point?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm leaning to go along with the Board of Selectmen.
Okay.
But I'm willing to wait till town meeting.
Yeah.
But I'm leaning that way that we just don't want the recreational.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just my personal feeling.
My only concern is that we need to do it in such a way that we don't do something that gets overturned by the state,
yeah.
and then you would be back where you started from,
yeah.
as opposed to waiting to see what their final rule is and then dealing with it then.
Yeah, and I can understand why you want to see what they say finally, but that is the way I think at this point.
Okay, any further questions or comments? Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm Michael Gilberto, Town Administrator. Just one point relative to the kind of developing situation regarding the recreational marijuana issue in Massachusetts. So Town Council, specifically Jonathan Eichmann at Copenhagen Page, did have some communication with the Assistant Attorney General charged with approving town bylaws. And the feedback that he got from her, which was within the past 2 weeks, was that in terms of a prohibition of sorts, like the one the commission is having a hearing on this evening, that the type of zoning bylaw that has been submitted would be the course of action that they would anticipate a town would proceed with. So I just want to provide that to the commission, that we effectively were advised as such by our attorney, who spoke with the Assistant Attorney General, that approves these bylaws for the board's information. Thank you.
So what you're saying is it would be done using the zoning bylaw is how it would be done?
For a prohibition of recreational marijuana in this way, yes. That's what we've been advised of, based on the law as written today.
Right.
Okay. Okay, any further comments or questions? Hearing none, then I'm going to close this public hearing. And I'm assuming the board is okay with making that decision at town meeting?
Sure.
Yeah. And actually, if we get any further information and we decide, we'll publish that. We're going to take a vote on it, you know, because there are a few things I would like some answers to, which I haven't had the opportunity to get yet. We did do a moratorium, if you remember, on medical. It worked out beautifully. It gave us an opportunity. We came up with a great law that went through the first time. We let some of the other communities make the mistakes, and we learned from them. And then we did a perfect law the first time through. So that's part of my concern, is I want to see what doesn't fly so that what we do does fly.
I understand.
Okay? All right. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Okay. Let's see. We got a few more minutes before we go to the amendments to the zoning bylaws. So,
let's see. Got some minutes you would
do. Let's do some minutes. Mr. Cody, would you, do you have some minutes you might present to us here?
Yes, which ones are we? Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to approve the minutes dated Tuesday, January 13, 2017.
Speak up, please.
I would like to make a motion to approve the minutes dated Tuesday, January 3rd, 2017.
Second.
We have a motion for January 3rd, 2017, and second. Is there any changes, any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Look at, let the record show, five in favor, no opposed.
I would like to make a motion to approve the minutes dated Tuesday, January 30th, 2017.
Second. We have a motion and a second. I was not at that meeting, so I will abstain. Any comments or questions on that? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? I abstain. So let the record show four in favor, the one abstention.
I would like to make a motion to approve the minutes dated Tuesday, February 7th, 2017.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any comments or questions? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. I'm going to abstain on that one also. So four in favor, one abstention, because I was not at that meeting. I did read through all those meetings, but I will abstain. Okay.
Still on the
okay. Do we have any, let's see. Want to look at any of the, do we have time for any ZBAs? And,
sure, we can get started.
Take a look. Oh,
wow.
We have an application from 28 Lowell for a special permit for 15 to 25 chickens. Hmm. Usually we don't object as long as there are no roosters.
I don't see any further information on it. That's all we have, is that one little sentence.
That's it.
Right.
A little hard to decide on that. But I guess my comments would be Board of Health. I'm assuming mm-hmm. they have Board of Health permit and proper facilities to maintain those animals and contain them. And, of course, the roosters, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Any comments from the board on that one? Any further?
It looks to me if maybe an egg, I mean, with that many chickens, we're going to be selling eggs. Or maybe she's just doing it for the meat, but that's a lot of chickens. It's a lot of eggs.
Yeah, that's a good point.
You can't eat that many eggs in a week, I don't think. You know, you're talking, if it's 15, that's what, 105 eggs if you get one a day, which is not unusual.
Okay.
So that perhaps might be something to look at.
Should ask exactly how this is all going to work out.
Okay, we can note those questions. Okay, then we have 35 to 37 Main Street, which is the application that is currently before the CPC for site plan review for self-storage and retail. I believe we'd indicated to them that based on the updates and revisions they made in their site plan review application, that the board would be supportive of the variance that they're seeking from parking. And actually, they also identified the need for a variance from loading requirements. They're required to have three docks, but will only have two. So I just wanted to see if there was any other feedback comments, things we want them to consider, other than that we support the plan as it's been submitted to the CPC.
Anybody on the board have any comments? I think we've gone through that fairly thoroughly with them, so I think we all know where we're going with that. So.
I think gentleman that's putting this forth is changed a lot since the first time we met him.
Right.
I mean, he came, you know, maybe there was some misunderstanding, and he tried to get a zoning relief on all his parking and just put what he wanted in there, and he came to us, and we told him we wouldn't support that, but we would support him if he did some other things, and he has. So, mm-hmm. you know, it's not a bad-looking building. It's going to be a lot of empty building, but mm-hmm. we might get some business out of it otherwise.
Right.
So.
So I guess we're going to be we'll be in support of that.
Okay. Okay. We have 100 Central Street.
It should be 108 Central Street, I think.
Oh, you're right. It should be 108 Central Street.
Yeah.
Okay. 108 Central Street for a hot sauce, a home occupation special permit for making hot sauce.
Okay, any comments from the questions from the board?
Mr. Pierce? Deliveries and shipments. That would be the only thing. I don't know how he's going to do all that.
I was thinking more along the lines of Board of Health oversight of the facility, the cooking facilities.
Well, I think that.
It appears that it's probably something that could be done within the confines of the bylaw as far as space, square footage, and all that goes. Mm-hmm. However, you know, Chris is right, the shipping of it or the and so forth, how that would all happen, and in whether or not the Board of Health is involved in overseeing the facility so that he doesn't ship something mm-hmm. that's not good. Not sure how that would work in a situation like this.
Okay. So. I can note those questions.
Yeah.
Should I say any comment about does not object if these are considered, or should I just raise these as comments and questions?
Well, as I said, it could probably be accomplished within the mm-hmm. square footage and within the parameters in the bylaw.
Okay.
Outside of the fact that other than the method for shipping or receiving, as Chris mentioned,
materials
there,
in and out.
And then again, and Mike, and that's a valid concern that he brought, but health is the other one, so. If those questions are adequately addressed, I suppose mm-hmm. we would be in okay with it.
Okay.
I think that's the answer. Yeah.
Okay. And then we have 127 Elm Street. There are a couple of images I've put in here, just the aerial view, the parcel map. This is an addition. The last PDF that you have in the folder is the plan that was submitted. And I also did a kind of a zoom out of the, it's not in here. I had done one that was a little further zoomed out. This property that you see that surrounds it is the back of McIntyre. It's owned by the Homeowners Association. It's under E. Okay, no, it's here. So just to kind of give you the context of what's around this parcel.
This addition is larger than the original house.
Yes, I see that.
If you've noticed, it's kind of like, and then he's going to violate that sideline by a lot, 7 feet 9 inches.
Yeah.
Just because it's unoccupied land, it's still a violation there.
Do we know who that so-called unoccupied parcel belongs to?
It's from McIntyre Crossing, that's the Homeowners Association owns it. I think it was open space from the subdivision.
Okay. So it's designated as open space in the subdivision, not something they could transfer to him in some way.
They could put access there, though, if they wanted to get in there and use it, you know, if you look at it.
Comes to kind of a point on Elm Street there, so.
Well, yeah, but they can get a driveway, and all of a sudden, you know, the house is right there, and then the trees are all gone. You know, it's one of those. It's built into his lot line. He's using the trees of the neighbors to...
I would imagine that our comment should be neighbors, which is usually what we say, and maybe a question on hardship, whether or not...
What is it?
Whether or not it could be done differently.
There isn't hardship for this, really. Right, there's no hardship for land.
Whether it could be done differently to be a little more sensitive to the zoning.
Okay.
Look at that. You're right on time. Are you warm? I'd like to shut it off.
Okay, being 7:30, I'm going to open the public hearing for the amendments to the zoning bylaws that we have. Do we want to make a presentation on any of these? Or?
Yeah, I have a few slides to do a brief overview. John has the public hearing notice. One of us can read it.
Okay. If you'd like. Sure, why don't you read the public hearing notice, please, John.
Okay. It's a long
I'll
one.
Read it.
Notice is hereby given that under the provisions of MGL Chapter 40A, Section 5, the North Reading Community Planning Commission will hold a public hearing on Tuesday, February 21st, 2017, at 7:30 p.m. in Room 414 of the North Reading Town Hall, 235 North Street, for the purpose of considering amendments to the Code of the Town of North Reading zoning bylaws as follows. 1. Amending the bulk and coverage controls and the minimum building size requirements of certain permitted uses of Section 200-40 pertaining to the Industrial Office Zoning District. Amending the provisions of Section 200-90, Multifamily Residential, to clarify their application. 3. Amending the definition of Overlay District in Section 204, Word Usage and Definitions. And number 4. Amending the zoning map of the Town of North Reading to add a new multifamily overlay zoning district consisting of the following parcels: 104 Lowell Road, Map 7, Parcel 2, 102 Lowell Road, Map 14, Parcel 148, 100 Lowell Road, Map 14, Parcel 9, 96 Lowell Road, Map 14, Parcel 142, and 96 Rear Lowell Road, Map 6, Parcel 3. And introducing new zoning regulations into the zoning bylaw to regulate uses in the multifamily overlay zoning district. The complete text and map relative to the proposed amendments is available for inspection at the Community Planning Office at North Reading Town Hall, 235 North Street, North Reading, Mass., between the hours of 8 and 4 p.m., Monday through Thursday, and 8 and 1 p.m. Friday, published in the North Reading Transcript, February 2nd and 9th, 2017. Thanks.
Thank you, Danielle.
Changes. I don't know if this is working okay. I'll just speak up. So these are changes relating to the proposed development at 104 Lowell Road, or I should say redevelopment. These are changes that we have gone through and deemed necessary in order to make possible the redevelopment proposal that's been made for the this portion of the former J.T. Berry property, which is the age-restricted 450 units of multifamily housing. And it consists of changes to four sections of the zoning bylaw. The first is changes to the existing multifamily zoning district. So this is to clarify what the difference is between the multifamily zoning district that exists now and how those provisions relate to what's being proposed. Establishing a new overlay over the Berry property and its surrounding properties in order to allow the 55 and over, or I should say, in order to allow the multifamily housing use. There is Article 3, which makes changes to the underlying industrial office zoning district, which applies throughout town, anywhere that industrial office property exists, and some changes to the word uses and definitions, and I'll explain each of these. So the first one, there is an existing bylaw in our zoning that pertains only to the properties at the property at 113 Harrell Street. And this is the Residence M, the multifamily zoning district. It's a very small property. I'll skip ahead actually just to look at this map. This is the Railroad Ave condo development. This zoning district was created to allow for this development, and it was a map amendment, and it was also a text change. And the bylaw that goes with it has certain provisions that pertain to multifamily housing in North Reading, but it says multifamily housing in Residence M only in some provisions and not in others. So this change to the bylaw would clarify that Residence M provisions only apply to Residence M zoning district, not every multifamily housing development in town. For example, it has rules that say that the height can't exceed 2.5 stories. That's actually contrary to where we have multifamily housing elsewhere in town, you know, most notably at the Edgewater, at the Edgewood apartments, where the height limit in that zoning overlay district allows for 4 stories. So this is really just a clarification that we do have a small zoning district called Residence M that has certain provisions that go with it, and it just goes along to each of those provisions and clarifies that that only applies to Residence M. There's another multifamily housing overlay district that would go over the properties that we're actually looking to add this use to. So we have the proposed development. Let's see if this is on. Okay. So the Pulte development is what's proposed, the age-restricted housing. This is 102, this is 104 Lowell Road, this is 102, which is also for sale. This is the Edgewood Apartments, Rita Mullen Field, and other town-owned property. So the proposed overlay zoning district would be for that entire section of what is currently zoned as industrial office. It doesn't change the underlying base zoning. It simply adds a new overlay which allows for this additional use of multifamily housing. The underlying IO zoning remains intact. There's a provision in this proposed multifamily zoning overlay district that controls, that states that all the dimensional and density controls are as stated in the underlying zoning. So there are a couple of exceptions to that. So building separation needs to be twice the required side yard setback. There's another provision currently in industrial office that requires for a much greater setback between buildings. This is something that I have, I've sent this question and some documentation about it to the fire department to make sure that they didn't have any issues with it. I have not gotten any feedback on that. I haven't heard that there is any issue with that. The other difference between the overlay and the and what's allowed in industrial office currently would be for parking. So currently, all parking spaces in North Reading need to be 10 by 20 feet. Otherwise, they need relief from the Zoning Board of Appeals. This overlay would allow for indoor garage spaces only, parking spaces as small as 9 by 18. And that was something that was pretty critical to the proposed development. Two spaces per unit are still required. This was something that we had talked about a little bit, whether this is something that we would want to consider for a lesser parking, but it was decided that this board really felt strongly that two parking spaces per unit was what we should stay with, which is the zoning that applies elsewhere in town. Again, just the map to show which parcels would be affected by this. This is currently industrial office. And it would be these five contiguous properties. Other changes are proposed that affect all of industrial office. So it would be not only this section of industrial office, but all of Concord Street. These are actually changes that the CPC has previously talked about and had planned to bring forward at a future town meeting anyway. Changing the minimum building height. Currently it's at 50 feet. We had talked about going up as high as 80 feet. What we came to is that 60 feet would be an appropriate height limit currently to change it to. Just, you know, in recognition that it can be difficult to get the kind of a development that we've been looking for at only 50 feet. And we had also heard feedback that in order to make this development work, they really needed 60 feet. This was something that this board had talked about as being appropriate elsewhere in town for industrial office. There's a clarification that was needed. There is an existing provision that says that when you have garage parking, it doesn't count toward a height limit up to a story and a half. We also wanted to clarify that there's a number of feet associated with that. So it's a story and a half or 15 feet does not count toward the height measurement when you have garage parking. And there was another provision that this board has also discussed and has previously agreed that it would be a good idea to make a change. In industrial office, if you want to have a certain type of retail business, most retail is restricted to buildings that are 50,000 square feet or greater. And we have previously talked about this being a provision that's probably unnecessarily restrictive and could potentially be problematic. It doesn't actually affect the particular proposal that's been made for 102 Lowell Road, the age-restricted housing. It actually doesn't affect that at all because there is no retail in that space. But it could potentially affect 102 Lowell Road, which is the other property that the town is looking to sell, and also just seemed like something that we should get rid of as being a little bit just unnecessary. Another change that's proposed is just to our board uses and definitions. We have a definition of overlay district, which is a little bit problematic because it states that where you have an overlay and you have base zoning, it's always the more restrictive that controls. It's actually not. An overlay can be more restrictive where there are additional rules and regulations that have to be followed, or it can be less restrictive. And we actually have both. So we have, you know, the Aquifer Protection District, which has an additional set of rules that you have to follow in addition to base zoning, or you can have something that's less restrictive, like the very smart growth overlay, the 40R district. That's an overlay district that just allows for more types of uses and is a less restrictive zoning district. So we really wanted to change this, which would have been an inconsistency in our zoning bylaw anyway, and could have potentially created a problem for the proposed development, and just eliminate the provision that says that it's always the more restrictive that controls, because sometimes it's the less restrictive that controls. And so that's a basic overview of the four changes that affect industrial office and the properties around the former Berry Center. And I'll turn it back to Warren.
Thank you, Daniel. Just for those who don't, aren't completely clear on why we're making all these changes, it has to do with the sale of that Berry property, the remaining Berry property, and we need to make some of these zoning changes in order to allow us to entertain the offers that we've had and move forward with that sale. So these are relatively important. They're not just something we came up with. They're important to moving forward with that whole process. And I know that she mentioned for a minute there about the parking and without saying why, one of the reasons that we stuck with the two cars per thing is because there's no public transportation over there. If you had public transportation, you could have probably put some wording in to limit the number of parking spots or the number of garage areas, which is not a great use of property. However, in this case, there is no public trans, and so the two parking spots per unit is we held on to that. So. Okay, any comments or questions from the board? Okay, now I'm going to open up to the public for any comments or questions on any of those amendments or zoning bylaws you saw. Anybody have any comments or any questions on them? Okay, hearing none, I'm good. I will then close the public hearing. I believe we'll hear these again before the town meeting at the Board of Selectmen's meeting. So if you think of anything, you'll have another opportunity to comment or question on them.
Do we want to make a recommendation?
I'm sorry?
Would we like to make a recommendation, or do we want to hold
it? Oh, yes. Yeah, of course. Okay. Yeah, we can.
On this one, yeah, I think.
I just wanted to make sure everybody was all set. No more questions, no more comments. Mr. Briscoe.
Just a quick comment. I want to thank all the members of the CPC for taking such quick action on this. We do appreciate the support. We know that we put a really tight timeline on you by picking March 13th as our special town meeting. And I know you pushed a lot aside other business to do this. And I just want, on behalf of the Board of Selectmen, to thank every one of you for working so hard and diligently to get us to this point.
Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I believe we can. You have a motion for us to a motion of support. Or do you want to make that?
We can just make a motion to support the four amendments at town meeting.
Okay, Mr. Cole, do you agree with that motion?
Yes.
Okay, so moved then.
Second.
And I have a motion and a second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Let the record show 5 in favor, no opposed. We support the amendments completely.
I think that's it.
Okay. Continue public hearing coming up.
We're actually ahead of schedule.
Pardon?
We're ahead of schedule.
Well,
we are.
Usually we thought there might be a little more comment, more questions, so.
Oh, who seconded? I think Chris seconded it. Chris, this is the second? Okay, thanks.
You want to do you have some updates for us?
Let me see. The informational hearings, the informational hearings for warrant articles will be March 6th at the Board of Selectmen meeting. Did we have a time? It's 8 o'clock, I think. I think so.
You have a schedule for those yet, Mike?
I'd have to defer to the town administrator, but I believe it's 8 o'clock.
That's correct. 8 o'clock.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mike.
I just wanted to mention, if anyone wanted to do the Citizen Planner Training Collaborative, there's an all-day training in March. Sorry, I think it's March 23rd. It's a Saturday. I know Bill said he wanted to do it. If anybody else wants to do it, I'll send around the link. It actually, the way we needed to set it up, we've done it before. You actually have to put in your credit card and get reimbursed. But I just wanted to bring that up if anyone else is interested in doing that. Let's see if we have anything else. Then that's not the day. Let me see if I can find the date for you. Sorry. Take a look.
Yeah.
I'll find the date and send it back around again. It's toward the end of March and it's a Saturday.
Okay.
I had another follow-up inquiry from the Brownie Troop that had asked about the history of our town colors and street signs. I had learned that it was inspiration of Notre Dame that made the schools vote in the 50s to make those the North Reading colors, which I thought was interesting. Then a follow-up question, which is, when did we decide to have the street signs changed from black and white to yellow
green.
And gold? Or sorry, to gold and green, and I was wondering if anyone happened to know that. There are a few left, but I don't see very many of them.
Mm.
And I couldn't find that in our subdivision regulations when we started telling people to install them.
When we changed the signs to green and gold?
About 10 years ago, really?
Maybe 12, yeah,
something like that.
At least. Time flies.
Mrs. Romeo probably knows
that. No.
Yeah.
Dave Hanlon on the colors.
Right.
That's when he decided the state was, there was some kind of a change the state wanted, so Dave, and you could do the colors that Dave said, we will do the green and the gold.
Yeah.
And that was 10, 15 years ago. It was
something
that
like that.
Yeah. Well, obviously in Dave Hanlon's reign when he was
there.
So.
Yeah, it was near the end.
That's approximation for you there.
Was it during the 62 reconstruction?
Pardon me?
No. Oh, Route 62.
Yeah, Route 62,
I don't know,
because the state was going to supply all those signs, and we had to tell them what color to make them.
Yeah.
I don't remember, to be honest.
Those are the ones on 62,
yeah. Yeah. Mrs. Romeo probably knows that answer. She's good with that kind of history.
What the state did, they came out with, like in the town of Reading, they had the wood signs they used to make.
Right.
Couldn't use them anymore.
Right.
You had to use a standard sign, and you had two choices on the height of the letters.
Right. Right.
Yeah. Make them color. Yep. Everybody in the state had to go. But 10, 15 years, yes, so much.
Okay. Thanks. That's all I have for now.
Okay. Okay, we still have a few minutes before our, 8 o'clock continued public hearing for 20 Main Street. So. I guess we can take a short break if you'd like. Okay, being 8 o'clock, I'm sorry, I'm going to open the public hearing for 20 Main Street. It's a continued public hearing. So, gentlemen.
Yes, good evening. For the record, my name is Brian Dunnan. I am a site civil engineer with J. O'Connell and Associates. I have with me tonight attorney Michael Fadden, the project's land use attorney. I also have with me property owner Mr. John Lucci, Mr. Gene Sullivan, who is John Lucci's site civil engineer, who also assisted me with this project. Mm-hmm. Our traffic engineer, Mr. Giles Hamm, and Mr. Lou Meister from TM Crowley, the CBS developer. Essentially, as you mentioned, Mr. Chairman, we're here as a continuation of the December 20th Planning Board hearing, in which the Planning Board has asked us to take a hard look at the drawings and try to address a number of the comments that have came up at that hearing. We believe we have addressed those, and I'll summarize those quickly in a minute. We did make a submission of updated site plans back early this month, around February 3rd. So just to kind of quickly summarize, the site plan submission set that was filed on the 3rd of February was revised as follows. We did add to the plan set an 8-foot-high noise attenuation fence. The noise attenuation fence is proposed to be installed along the entire rear property line of East Gate Plaza. So essentially, we begin at the property corner of 3 Verdict Road. It would run in a northerly direction to its property corner with 17 Burton Road. We have provided details of that fence as part of the site plan submission package. We have also added to the site plans bike rack locations that was requested at the last hearing. There are 2 sets of bike racks being planned. One would be located at one of the CVS parking lot area, which general location. And there's a second set of bike racks to support the small store, identifies a small store adjacent to this corner right here, which is adjacent to the auto zone area. Another area that we were asked to look at, we heard some comments regarding some traffic, internal traffic flow on the property. Of concern was that the existing curb cuts located along Main Street, there appears to be a lot of conflicts with vehicles entering and exiting from Main Street into the site with internal flow. So what we have proposed, or a way to alleviate that problem, is we have the 2 curb cuts that we are maintaining. We have kind of defined parking as follows. We have defined the flow where traffic would come in and out in a defined pattern, be operated under stop bar control. We have also added additional curbing and parking along, we pushed it back a little bit off of Main Street. And again, define the ends of the rows with island end caps. And again, with more pronounced, the northerly most curb cut, such that customers and vehicles entering and exit the site will have a clear path of travel to channelize themselves through it and eliminate that cross diagonalization of people trying to get out and meet the light. In addition to that, there was also a concern that was raised from our site plan set about some sight line conflicts at the CVS pharmacy window as it exited with respect to the location of the compact area. So to alleviate those problems, what we've done is we have removed the compact or dumpster area from being attached to the rear building wall and located in this general corner and here. We have added some traffic control striping and signage to, again, further facilitate traffic circulation and movements. We've identified a striped area for the loading zone so that when the delivery truck is at the store, it's up against the building and allows clean lines of sight at the pharmacy window to exit and navigate through the
problem. I don't think he's good enough.
In addition to that, it was a request made, if you remember, the initial photometrics plan that we submitted, which is primarily focused in on the CVS portion of the parking facility. We have expanded that and included the entire photometrics plan of the entire parking facility area. And in addition, we've updated our landscaping plan. This all should be noted as we've added island end caps to define the main travel ways throughout the center. We have also landscaped those, and we've also updated our landscape plan to include plantings along the additional green areas, as well as include a staggered row of green hula arborvitae trees that would be installed along the
area.
Property between the noise attenuation fence and the edge of the curb. So there'll be two buffering mechanisms in place to screen the project and the noise from the abutting residences along Burton Road. Since our December 20th, so in summary, those are the plan changes that have been performed to date, that they have been submitted in the package that I indicated to Danielle earlier in the month. Since that time, we have received our final peer review response letters, both from a stormwater management perspective as well as a traffic impact perspective. In short, both letters from DCI consultants have concurred with the methodologies, findings, and conclusions in both the traffic and stormwater management reports, and had no further comments. There were two minor comments with respect to the drainage study that we performed that DCI recommended to put the planning staff that could be written as conditions should the project be approved, and take no exception to those supplement that little minor supplemental information that they asked for. We have also, since our last hearing in December, we have made a trip to the Conservation Commission. We had a meeting with the CONCOM in January. We believe, although I don't want to speak to that commission, the takeaway that I got from that meeting was we have adequately addressed all of their concerns at this moment. They are subject to holding off on a formal closing of the hearing and a vote on the project until we conclude our process with the planning board and as well as with the Board of Health. We have also submitted in the last leg of the permitting process that we're required to go through. We did make a submission about 2 weeks ago to the Board of Health's department requesting a septic system permit for the installation of a new septic system to accommodate CVS farms. So in summary, those are the changes that we made. That's the activity of the project that's occurred since our last meeting. We did receive in a copy of the staff summary report that was prepared by Danielle. We do concur with the findings of that report. We do respect the request that one of the issues that was, I believe, that may get talked about tonight happens deals with signage. Our application for site plan approval did not include a signage package. We're really not prepared tonight to speak about it, but we want to have to take feedback from it. But we'd like to keep that as a separate, we acknowledge we need permits for it, and we would like to keep that as a separate permit application in approval process, as it's going to take a little time between the sign vendor and the owner and the tenants to come up with a comprehensive package at that point. So if the board so chooses, what we would like to suggest, or I would like to suggest, is that that signage, that prior to the issuance of any, your recommendation was a condition that the separate signage package be approved prior to construction. Mm-hmm. We would like to take advantage, should the project be approved, we had to take advantage of beginning construction spring of this year, so we'd like to see if we could amend the condition that the signage package will be prepared and approved prior to the issuance of an occupancy permit.
I don't think so.
That's the only request, I guess, we would make on that end as to try to progress things along in an orderly and efficient manner. We recognize we need signage. We intend to prepare the package. It's just going to be lagging a little bit now that we hope that we're in the final stages closing out hearings with Planning Board, Conservation, and Board of Health with the whole bill of permits to be issued. So in summary, that's kind of where we stand. We'll turn this back over. We're going to make consultant team see if I can answer any questions that you may have. But I think we'd like to turn this back over to the board and address any comments or concerns that you folks may have.
Okay.
Joe. I looked at the plans, sir, and I really couldn't figure out exactly what it was. The plantings on the islands, on the traffic islands,
yes,
and the exit out onto Park Street, what type of plantings will those be? Will they be very low? Will they be low?
If you're referring, to these trees in here, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, these are trees in which they're 6 foot high branching type trees. They're, you know, linden, thin leaf trees, where the whole purpose is they're designed to be trees within the parking lots where you have six
feet. The site distance is what I'm thinking about.
Yeah, you have 6 feet of minimum of 6 feet of clearance of site distance. So they're limbing of trees doesn't begin until elevation 6 feet above pavement grade.
Okay, because I know that we have some. Well, there's one business in town. They had to go in and cut down all the things they put on the on the islands because you couldn't see. Now, what about going out onto Park Street? What's going to be over there? Is there any plantings over there?
There's on the side of Park Street that's close to the residential area.
Yeah.
That is an area where it's all shrubs and it's a wetland.
I'm sorry. I mean the driveway going out. Is there any plantings there?
There is some small tree plantings. Same thing, maple trees.
I think he addressed
where the branch height is 6 feet above the ground and higher. That's
going to have to be open.
There is no
site distance.
We do. We have the site distances from as you approach the intersection with Park Street. We have a clear line of sight in both directions to the intersection and looking right up towards
Park. Oh, no, excuse me. I'm thinking with the trees there. The trees, we're going to have a clear.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's just my concern because, mm-hmm. you know, that could be a problem. I did see those trees and I said, ooh, that could be a problem.
Jeffrey,
but if they're going to be 6-8 feet high,
yes.
Should be okay.
Yes.
Okay. Anybody else on the board here?
I got a bunch.
Well, let me just throw two things out
there
and then I recognize you. Small thing, but the bike racks, you got one on either side of the CVS.
Yeah.
One of them next to an auto parts store, which probably doesn't sell bike parts. Is it possible to move one down a little further so that the people that would go to like the other stores down there could, is it just not a good space further down?
Here's the challenge. Right now on the sidewalk with this 8 feet. For an ADA accessible route, I need to have 4 feet clear with no obstructions. When you put the bike rack in, then you try to work a 4 feet clear. By the time you get the bike rack in, either the rear wheel of the bike rack is going to
jet
into that 4 feet.
Could you put it in one of the parking spots up further up?
Yeah.
Close to the building?
One of the concrete no drive areas.
For over in this area?
It's okay to leave that one there.
The other one should,
I was wondering if it could be moved to the right there. Down.
Like in front of the restaurant.
Yeah.
The Mario's, right in there, and then you're splitting that building.
Yeah, there you go.
So
don't get it away from the building. Put it out in the parking lot.
Right. The short answer is going to be is I can take this island here and create a situation where
that would be, I think that would be far more convenient for people. They'd be able to work both ends of that building as opposed to having all the bike racks close together and having to walk, 600 feet down to the place where they're actually going. It's a small thing, but I think it makes a difference in the final build. My other comment would be on the northernmost exit and entrance and exit there. Yep. One of them still is directly behind one of those islands. Is it possible to line them up with the rows? The only reason I say that is because it makes it possible for the queue to be a straight line as opposed to, you know what I mean?
So the one of the challenges that we have an existing site light pole that we're trying to protect,
mm-hmm.
and it kind of so that's what you're seeing here with this landscape diagram.
Yep.
Kind of working that way out. as you're exiting this way, you'd have to stop here, and then we'd come back to here, so that we can look at improving that. But the problem is that I'm not going to be able to get a straight shot back up this island.
Well, the entrance is good. The entranceway is good. It drops you right into a lane that you can drive up and go to anywhere.
Right.
So, but it's the exit side that's going to create queuing problems.
Right in here.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Again, the way the light pole is situated, to get this to line up with this, the pole gets hit. The pole is in conflict.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know how you, I'm not sure exactly how, if Dan was here, he'd tell me how to do it, but but if there was a way to mitigate that at some point, if that becomes a minor change of some kind, we'd certainly accept it without.
Okay. Let me go back and look at that quickly, audio, and then I'll respond back.
Yeah, if you could do something simple to make that far more, because if they came down that other row, exit, if they knew, if there was a line there, a marking that said exit, and they took that down this row, then you'd have plenty of room to queue coming out and plenty of room to queue coming in if necessary. It would give you a nice flow. Mm-hmm. More important that the people leaving have a place to queue than the people coming in. If they have a high level of business in there, that queue could get all the way back and, you know, for example, when they have sales in the Christmas time, things like that. If there's a lot of stuff going on, a queue exiting could be long, and getting in doesn't matter because once they're in, they're going to go to whatever store they want.
Right.
It's almost as if you could move that over one way or the other so that the...
I think what you're asking for, if I may, is you'd like to see this exit lane kind of line up with this travel here and have a straight shot.
Yes, and then some marking letting people know that. It would make getting in and out of that thing so much easier.
I can take a look at that.
Yeah, it would make a lot of sense,
the
too.
The conflict right now is the pole, so I need to better understand what the issues are, relocating the pole.
I don't have any serious conflicts with what you have there, but I just know from driving in and out of there and from other places like that that's something that would make all the difference in the world to people getting in and out with ease. Okay? Mr. Hayden.
Okay. So I'm still unsure how you expect the travel behind the building. I understand how we're going to go to the pickup window, obviously, and then you've got another bypass lane. I'm not sure what that bypass lane is going to do us, because we don't want regular passenger cars to be driving behind the rest of the building.
Right.
That's there so you can leave?
Well, the intent is to serve two purposes. One is a second means of emergency access around the small store building. It gives fire apparatus, police apparatus, a second conduit just to circulate the buildings. The other means is that there are some smaller store tenants here, and what I mean by that is a fitness place, a nail salon, or even cleaners or a barber shop. Mm-hmm. And typically their deliveries are done with a UPS truck or a FedEx truck or whatnot. So this allows, in the event that these FedEx trucks come in, that they happen to be coming in off of Main Street, it gives them a conduit to be able to get to the back into these small store tenant areas where their product is in a cardboard box per se and allows access out. So provides a little bit of convenience on both ends. Again, it's a good break point because again, it serves as a queue lane for the pharmacy window, which is independent and allows some fire apparatus, ambulance.
So the travel behind the original building is all going to be south to north, or is it two way?
It's all in a clockwise direction.
Okay, south to north.
Yes.
Okay. Now, getting in and around the pharmacy from the south corner where you've moved the dumpsters?
Yes.
You got 12 feet before you get to the concrete pad. Where's the fence around the dumpster pad?
The fence is around, it's enclosed within, there is a small portion, about 12 feet of concrete, that is, instead of being paved, it's a concrete surface, with the intent that the trucks will come in, land on a concrete pad, and then...
So that's...
So a concrete pad is essentially 24 feet plus or minus in depth.
So your enclosure for your dumpsters is the exact size of those two dumpsters pushed in there?
It's, well, plus or minus a foot on either side to give them room to...
That's an awful close area for...
They're good.
I can see that. I can see either wall of that being taken out by the truck.
I can appreciate the comment. Again, CVS, this is the standard. This is a standard CVS design. They got the vendors that come in. They size the areas.
What I'm looking at here is we're going to have a tractor-trailer truck coming in here. At least twice a day, going to the liquor store. Probably more because the beer runs, the different beer companies. They got to go this way.
Yes.
So they can actually stay in that lane, making the turn. I know you've done. I know you've figured out that the fire truck can get back there.
Yeah.
So that truck is going to stay in that lane. So if there's an oncoming vehicle, which there will be from the pharmacy area. And then you've got a truck in the loading area. So the dumpster area is not going to get wiped out by a vehicle going...
Well, a couple of things. No, the dumpster area will not get wiped out.
I'd like to know what the distance is from the corner of the L.A. island there to the corner of your fence. I know it's 12 feet to the... 12 feet to the dotted line. I don't know if it's 12 feet to that corner. It looks awful tight right there. It would probably be, maybe, have you thought about turning it 90 degrees?
Well, then it would be in conflict. If I turn it 90, then I'm in conflict with the traffic coming out of this.
Huh? Say that again?
If I turn this 90 degrees...
And put it in the back? If the pad is 24 feet square...
No, it's not 24 square.
Okay. Well, I'm looking at it here, so I don't have any dimensions on this other than what you've written in. So...
That is 24 long
by 20 feet. By 20 feet wide?
24 feet long. So big. And the pad is 24 foot long. So 24
from east to west is 24 feet, which I'm looking at right here on your plan. I have the plan in front of me on that corner.
Okay. So
but I don't have the depth.
It's 20 feet.
20 feet. So then I'm guessing your fenced area is 10 by 24? Or 11 by 24?
It's 24 by 11, yeah, 11 by 24.
All right, it just looks like you might have more room going that way, but maybe if you've already tried it, then it just looks really tight there to that corner. And putting an enclosure in there and having it wiped out the first 6 months it's there is worthless because it's not going to get replaced. And those enclosures are to keep the trash inside of them. When it doesn't, you know, it doesn't make it in the dumpsters, and you understand that.
Absolutely.
That's not your issue, but it's just the way life is. The other thing, your photometrics.
Yes.
The northwest corner. You know that the photometrics requirement is that you get zero spillage onto other people's property, correct?
Yes.
You're spilling light into the animal the building that's on the right there. 24 Main. Thank you, Bill. And it's not like a little bit, it's a lot of spillage into that corner.
You got a light pole right on the corner of the property.
Yeah, that's the existing.
Right, so that's the existing condition.
Correct.
That's not what we were asking. Where are we? We will want to know what the final condition is going to be. Are you replacing those lights with LEDs?
With LEDs, yes.
So if you got the right LED light there, you should have been able to shield it properly so that your photometrics were giving you the right numbers instead of these numbers. You follow what I'm saying?
Yes.
Also, the wall packs in the back of the building, I don't know how you can shield those wall packs so that they do not impact the neighbors on the back of the building. They're going to be able to see visible light looking right at the units.
Well, there's three wall packs proposed along the rear of the CVS. There is no wall packs proposed along the CVS.
Yeah, and I don't understand, but okay.
With that is, again, we have an elevation change, you know, as we're going down, we have a bold evergreen trees and an 8-foot high attenuation fence. The wall pack lighting is only on until the store is in operation. Once the store shuts down at 10 o'clock at night, those lights are going off. They will not be on 24/7. In addition to that, there's also an internal, these wall packs have an internal optic shield, which directs the light directly downward. As can be seen from the photometrics, when we have about 1 foot candle as you go away from the building on the curb line of the rear access drive, and it quickly drops off to zero before it hits the property.
Yeah, well.
There's no light exposure.
So you're telling me you could calculate that there, but you forgot to calculate that with the new light in the front corner. I have an issue with that. Can we get some technical designs on those wall packs so I could review them? Yes. And your sound attenuation fence. You're missing that property right on the corner there. Coming around the corner on the back drive, which looks right into the back of the property. Yeah, right there. We had talked about this in the December meeting, about bringing that fence down around there. And it seems to have dropped off the board. The most noise is going to be right in that back corridor, correct?
I would disagree. Probably, if there's any noise, it'd be because, again, CVS has all its deliveries in the morning.
I didn't say it was at night.
It depends on
when you sleep. It depends on when you're trying to enjoy your you know, your privacy.
I don't disagree.
Okay, so whenever there's a delivery, any of those cars running back there, you're in a little tunnel. So I know that we had brought that up to catch the back, at least that back of that property. I wasn't talking about going all the way around to Park Street, but I know I was talking about the back of that property. There is a stockade fence now, which you're taking down, that covers the back of that property. Am I correct?
We're not touching the stockade.
Not touching the stockade fence.
Oh, wait a minute. Did you look at your plans? It says remove the stockade fence right there.
Yes.
Please.
If I may, the stockade fence that we are removing. Existing stockade fence that runs parallel to the Verdant Road residence.
Right, and that's actually all in one. It just curves. It's the same fence. So when you call out something on the back corner and you say remove fence, that means the whole fence that's all contiguous, and that's a contiguous part of it.
We have identified the windows of the fence as removed. We're not planning on removing any fencing with the property of 367 Park Street. That's not the intent.
Okay.
Shh. Let him finish. We'll have some time for questions when we get a little further along.
Yeah, it also is not on your drawings. Because I can see your drawings really good when I zoom them in.
I'm okay.
Okay. I still think the sound fence there would be even better than your than the old stockade fence, which I'm sure is 20 years old or plus. I may be incorrect on that age, but I'm taking a guess.
The The fencing that you're referring to, the angles across three
Right, and I don't expect you're going to be able to continue that there because it's going to be in your way.
That's right.
Construction. But, so you're taking it down?
Yes.
Right, that's what I just said. You said you weren't.
I was under the impression you were referring to a stockade fence that was on property of 360.
Well, I'm not, you can't touch their fence.
No, we're not touching any of that, but yeah, we're touching fence that's on our property.
Right, and I'm looking at it right here, right across that it says to be removed.
Yes.
But that's, I'm asking you to replace it along the line where you can. And if you can, I want to know why. What was the other thing? Was there something else? I think that's all I got right at the moment. Oh, I got it. I can show it to you. It's right here. Just went by it. You find it where it says remove. To be removed, right across that angular part.
Yeah, that's under existing conditions.
Right.
Because I was looking at it under the new plan.
I didn't see anything there under the new plan. No. So no. What he's talking about is the fence that they don't own.
Chris, are you?
I was just gonna. Where is the septic you're getting? Department of Health. Permits for, yeah. For the CVS. Where is that gonna go? I thought it was their septic was gonna go where the liquor store is now.
It is.
It is. So in other words, have the.
So you're going to temporarily tie into the other plaza?
That is correct.
Okay.
And those plans are a little busy, but CVS is here. The new CVS septic system is planned for right in here, which is within the footprint of the Eastgate Liquors. So
okay.
As part of the phasing process, we will be looking for a temporary connection to the
existing. Right. I just thought it was early to get a permit for that when the building's still standing there. Obviously, it's got
to
be.
Soil testing.
You can't do soil testing.
Digging holes in the middle of the building. Yeah,
it can be kind of tough. So, I'm not saying you're not doing the right thing. I'm just, it's just kind of, for me, it's how do you soil test when you can't get there because there's a building sitting on top of it?
We tested around the
perimeter. I know you're going to be removing all the concrete and stuff,
yes.
So you're going to be down probably 4 feet anyways.
Yes.
Okay. It's going to be a lot of fill.
Yes.
Okay.
You good, Chris, for now?
Yeah, there's still some questions on the abutters.
Yeah, the abutters. We're going to get into
letters.
The abutters.
Okay.
I'll be quick. Thank you for moving those dumpsters. I do agree to kind of tighten that corner, but at least the drive-through has great sight lines. I can visualize myself going around there, not having to worry about a vehicle. Going to the photometrics, in the northwest corner where there's absolutely no light, I'm looking at the employees of this place having to go out at 5 o'clock at night to throw trash. And they have no light. I understand that the residents don't want the light, but with LED lights set properly, I think we can get some light back there and increase the safety of the employees at the building. Even if it's light poles on the far east or the west side and shadowing them in, or wall packs with an angle down. It's just some kind of lighting out there. There's nothing there.
I can't believe they have no light.
Again, point noted, again, we're just trying to be sensitive to the concerns of the residents back there with lighting. We do not want to do anything more than what's currently being practiced today. And if take no exception to evaluating putting a little bit of light back there.
Let me just make a quick comment. You know, I think probably you're going to have a pretty high fence back there, the noise fence, 8 foot tall.
8 foot, yes.
So if you were to put a wall pack 7 feet up, the shield on that wall pack will be a foot below the top of the fence. So you'd light everything below that and nothing above it. So I think the real key here is the placement, the elevation placement of that wall pack. I think you could put one back there. Would do what he wanted, what he's talking about, and you wouldn't, and none of it would spill because your lip would be below the top of the fence. I think that's the most practical way to address it.
To put it right, just above the door, the frame of the door.
Yep, yeah, if you're looking for safety, because that would provide the light for footing and basically what he's talking about with no spill.
79. Building's at 80.
That's all right.
That works for you?
Yep. Are we looking, just so I'm clear, I understand the area by the dumpster, but are we also looking for the entire length of the small store?
Minimum lighting, just enough to, you know, in the same kind of scenario, after whenever they close, the lights go off, just to give a little safety back there for the employees.
Yeah.
And again, keeping them low in the building will eliminate any spill.
Mm-hmm.
They won't even see them. Okay, Joe, you have anything you
would No, I'm all set.
John?
I like the placement of the dumpster. I had a concern also about the lighting in the back, about there not being any. Mm-hmm. It just seems way too
odd. Yeah.
Way too dark.
Yeah, I it's not that the lighting, it's the kind of lighting.
As long as it's done properly.
Yeah.
Right. You know, it won't affect the neighbors. And
they won't even see them.
You know, people being out there at nighttime, it's not going to be very, it's going to be dark without it.
And they're going to be out there.
The lights in the front corner over by the animal, whatever the place is over there, I mean, those are existing poles. They could probably adjust the heads.
They're going to replace all the heads, though, John.
Well, they're going to have to because they're going to do LED heads
right.
Anyway to match the other LED
well,
heads.
Well, what I was basically saying is this. He didn't calculate them with what he's going to put in there. He's given us what he's got today, and we didn't ask for what today is. We asked what it's going to be.
Well, what he probably did was take the existing poles that are there and put the LED head on, which this is what you get.
That's exactly what he did.
Yeah, so, you know.
Yeah, but we needed what it's going to be, you know, final, without spillage.
That is what's going to be final.
That's it.
Well, no, we don't want any spillage. So he has to shield it. It's a shieldable light, I'm sure.
Yeah.
They're all shieldable.
Right.
And they can shield it. That's right on the property line, and I know they can shield it right down to the property line.
You could shield it, but if the existing pole is a certain height, you can only shield it so much.
Mm-hmm. It's a 12-foot pole? How tall is the pole?
How tall are those poles?
No, the existing pole is 25.
Right. 25-foot thing, you'd have to have a shield that went under it and blocked the hole. You'd have to turn the light off pretty much.
You'd be surprised with those lights.
I think you're asking for a lot for an existing pole that's there. See if you can shield it any better way, but I don't
know.
I'll look
at
some
options.
Yeah.
We did it over here.
Well set?
Right down to the left.
So,
fence.
We have a couple letters from abutters. Have you been provided with copies of the abutter letters that we have?
No.
Okay.
I've received the staff letter. I did receive a letter from Nancy.
Yeah,
for came
out
Friday last week.
That's
what
just came in today.
Okay.
Okay, I don't see.
No. I had an email from Danielle.
After we spoke, I summarized all the points because we were waiting for a letter, and then the letter came in on I guess Friday, and then that letter got distributed. But I don't think you actually saw a copy of the letter.
Yeah. So to clarify the chairman's question is no, I haven't received it, but I did receive a summary letter from Danielle on Friday. Conversation between Danielle and
okay, and so Danielle, you provided him with all of the issues in the pages C1 and C2 and all that.
I'm sorry.
You provided him with a breakdown of what's in this letter.
I hadn't actually seen the letter. We had a conversation over the phone. I summarized what the issues were. I guess the letter did come in. I didn't even realize the letter's in the Dropbox, but I wasn't in the office when the letter came in. So I guess we should go through each of the issues in the letter.
Well, we can do that. Before I open it up to the public, I thought that we would go through these couple letters because they may answer a lot of the questions for people right up front. It might make things a little easier. So I'm going to deal with the first letter quickly. And this is, I'm not going to get into any great detail, but just the concerns. It's actually from 3 Burdett Road. It's, my concerns are as follows. The disruption of the wetland property will cause more flooding on my property than I normally get. excuse me, as discussed at the neighborhood meeting on December 8th, I do not have a stockade fence. Will one be put up along the end of Burdett Road and continue to Park Street? Will it be left after construction and be maintained? Also extend the 8-foot sound barrier fencing behind my property as it is being installed behind the other Burdett Road properties, and I think that's the point that Chris made.
With respect to, I think that was the comment from 3 Burdett Road.
yes.
A couple of things. One is the noise attenuation fence will be installed across the entire length of 3 Burdett Road. That is shown on the plans.
Okay.
With respect to drainage, there will be no, the drainage has been peer reviewed by Green Town Selected Consultant. The findings of that report have indicated that the methodologies and the conclusions that we have come to will result in that there be no irreparable damage to abutters or to downstream residents. We are required as part of a previous permit application to, as part of this renovation, is create a 5,600 square foot wetland mitigation area. That mitigation area is in this area location. This will have no impact of increased flooding, water issues associated with 3 Burdett Road. Again, just to reiterate that this comment came up again at the Conservation Commission hearing we had in January. At that point, we did receive a peer reviewer's letter that confirms that everything's been designed towards not only town ready stormwater policy standards, but also Mass DEP stormwater policy standards with no detrimental impacts to the surrounding areas.
Okay, thank you. A lot of times people don't understand how detailed some of these designs are and how much thought goes into them. So I do want to say that if after this is built, if there's a problem where an increased amount of water for some reason does happen, you could certainly let us know and we would ask you to come back and relook at it. And just so everybody have a level of comfort that you're not going to walk away. This is going to be here. And if it doesn't work the way it's supposed to work, there will be mitigation of it.
Nope. We're not walking away. Mr. John Lucci is on the property.
Yes, I know.
CBS is here, so I mean, we're the duration.
I know John's gone to a lot of trouble to make sure this is right, you know, to make sure this is good, and we hope it all works well for him. It's nice for North Reading to have a new building and have it look good, so we appreciate it. Okay, at the second letter from abutter has a number of things on it. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to read probably 3 of them, and then we'll discuss them, and then we'll do 3 more because there's a number of items. That way we don't get too bogged down in trying to remember what we had. It says the demolition plan states existing stockade fence is to be removed. It was agreed on that the stockade fence would remain during and after the construction. The fence would be maintained by Lucci Realty Trust, and fencing would be placed by 357 Park Street and 3 Burdett Road during and remain after. Now, they're talking about stockade fence.
Yes. And that comment refers to when the comments came up about the noise attenuation fence and the construction in the back. One of the scenarios that I was looking at, the feasibility was maintaining the existing stockade fence,
mm-hmm.
do the filling of the drainage ditch, and install the noise attenuation fence 5 feet off the proposed curb line. That was one of the scenarios that we were looking at. The more I got into thinking about construction means and methods, and the more I evaluated the feasibility of maintaining that fence is, it can't be maintained. It's going to come down only because the area is heavily vegetated, so all the trees need to be cut down, the roots need to be pulled. Mm. And as you pull the roots, you're gonna pull the fence down.
Mm.
So in light of that scenario, and the grading is such that they need the entire width of the green space to grade that area to fill the ditch in. The means and methods of the approach changed a little bit, where we decided that it made much more practical sense to put the noise attenuation fence, have that act as the noise attenuation fence slash stockade fence. Mm-hmm. It is a wood fence, 1x6 pine on the neighbor's right. side, and the insulation, foam insulation, and then there'll be a backing to it, so the neighbors will get the good side of that fence. Mm-hmm. And that achieves the same purpose as the stockade fence does. It provides a visual barrier, yet we have the noise foam in the middle, and then we supplemented that by, as the grade comes up to the site, mm-hmm. the staggered row of arborvitaes would act as a visual barrier as well. So right. we tried to maintain it, we could not. However, we do understand that we are sensitive that this is a residential area. So in understanding one of the first stages of construction is going to be to do the activity back here. So during construction, we are proposing or showing on the plans that there will be a temporary 6-foot chain link fence installed along the rear to keep the residential, the children within the residential area from using it as a shortcut to get to the mall and get themselves into, or get, attempt to get through right. on site.
Right.
So the plan is to have a temporary chain link fence up during construction. Once the area has been, the ditch has been filled in, the area has been rough graded, you would then install the noise attenuation fence. We would fine grade the area with loam and seed. We would fine grade the area with loam, seed it, and then plant the trees, and then work inboard from there. So to address that comment, yes, there was an evaluation process where we did consider trying to save the existing mm-hmm. fence, but construction means and methods and practicality, it's not going to survive. So right. we mixed it.
Okay, and the next comment was, our fencing is gone from the plan, but I think you've addressed all that.
Yes.
Okay, traffic flow. It looks like Park Street and Main Street entrances follow one way between the new CVS and existing building. No note of arrows showing either way behind the buildings. No signage that says trucks entering one way. Also, new on the plan is the loading area for liquor store. Which way do these trucks come in?
Yeah. As mentioned previously, we were planning a south to north. Mm-hmm. You know, clockwise direction. So the bigger delivery trucks will enter in off of Park Street, this curb cut. They will take a left, travel along the side of CVS and then towards the rear. CVS is designated loading area is in this location. And then if it's for the liquor store, mm-hmm. one of the comments that we got from the previous meeting was that they would like to see the loading area delineated for the expansion area associated with the liquor store. So that's what we have proposed here. We have striped it such that there's a solid white edge line to kind of delineate the travel way all the way around the front of the building, and then we'll be exiting out towards Main Street.
Okay. It says an 8-foot high noise fencing is noted, but it does not show that the fencing will continue onto Kingston Street and Park Street as suggested at the meeting.
Yes, we're proposed, with respect to the noise, the fencing was planned along the entire length of the rear property. We did propose some evergreen buffering for the property of 367. We've heard tonight comments about extending yep. that fence down. Noted, we need to evaluate that.
Okay.
However, along the north side, which is, I believe, the Kingston Road side. Yeah, the area, we're not proposing any land disturbances within this portion of the drainage basin to remain. It is heavily vegetated. There's a fence up there right now. So it didn't make sense to go in and do more clearing and grubbing to try to get the noise attenuation fence in. But we wanted to leave that in its natural state and really do more policing on site to minimize and mitigate the noise that is, if they're currently experiencing, is to mitigate it on site with due diligence with emptying trash, coordinating times on trash, and snow removal operations and the like. I just think that, it's heavily vegetated, get mature trees in there, to try to install an 8-foot fence, then this area is going to require additional tree cutting and whatnot to occur. And to me, I think policing may be the easier way to go. And then if that doesn't work, is aggressive as a long-term going forward once we get a better understanding as to what the specific problem is.
Okay. It says landscape plan shows Fraser firs in between the arborvitaes. That was not what was agreed to on at our meeting. All arborvitaes were to be used.
Yeah, again, just a little bit of flavor to mix up a little bit. If that's if it's all arborvitaes, then that's what we'll do. We'll make the change. Mm-hmm.
Well, again, this is this letter says that there was an agreement that that's what would happen.
The request was the green pool of arborvitaes, and the majority of them are. We just kind of broke the species up a little bit.
What is the difference between the arborvitae and the Fraser fir as far as noise or visual?
To be honest with you, it's just a visual thing. I'm not an expert.
It's prettier. It's prettier with the variation.
It is, Warren, but the hulas will grow 4 feet a year, 2 to 4 feet a year. They grow really fast.
Yeah.
So what they put in there, they'll be, by the time they're done construction with the liquor store, mm-hmm. they'll be 2 feet taller. Mm-hmm. You know, and I'm not, you know, maybe you do put some in there, but drop down the number of trees and make sure you got a decent. It's always good to put a variety of trees in, because if something comes in and kills one, it doesn't kill them all.
Well, that's, yeah.
Same as what's in your parking lot.
Yeah.
You know, we always use those same trees, and you get a blight that comes in, and you lose them all. You look at the Dutch elms, and you can look at the chestnuts.
Right.
We take notes after the chain and call, too.
Yeah. Okay. So it says on page 16, the truck circulation plan shows the truck on Park Street to swing onto the curb cut. To do this, it shows the truck going left into traffic on Park Street to make the turn and driving on the side of traffic coming in the other direction.
Yeah, I think the comment is that...
if you get a full-size tractor trailer with a 53-foot trailer on it...
Yeah, 50-foot trailer. Yeah, that's...
You're going to have to make that...
The roadway geometry, that's what it does today, that's what it's doing tomorrow, and that's what it's going to do in the future. This shopping center is no different than any other shopping center.
Well, the truck's coming down Main Street, making the turn onto Park Street there, headed for Concord Street. They have to get in the left-hand lane to make the right-hand turn. Because there's a double lane coming east and only a single lane going west, so they need to take the entire roadway to make that turn. So, I mean, that happens right now, and I think that's what they're seeing, but I don't know what you can do about that, okay. Since that's the configuration of the state road.
Yeah, it's a roadway geometrics. There's nothing really we can do about it. It's a condition that exists with any of those delivery trucks. Along that corridor, to come in. Although the model is, you know, that's what this is. It's a simulated model. It is a 53-foot long truck, so mm-hmm. You know, the truck driver does whatever truck does. Wait for the traffic to pass. Right. So go for a quick second approach, make the turn in, and then off he's gone.
So the last item is in between CVS and AutoZone. It shows a one-way drive-through and entry. Will there be signs for right turn only or for trucks only in one way? Clarify the in and out traffic pattern of trucks. It seems it would make sense to enter and leave from the same exit on Main Street, not the curb cut. I think what they're saying is that southern entrance on Main Street would be the best place for them to come in and out. I think that's what they're indicating there.
If they were traveling north on Main Street, if a delivery truck was traveling north on Main Street, mm-hmm. then I would tend to agree with you that make this left turn into the site
yep.
would be it, is a lot easier. CVS's loading facility is in this corner, mm-hmm. so it's difficult for a CVS delivery truck to come to here and try to, they cannot make this left turn, cannot make that right turn. That's why we're proposing Park Street. Since we're proposing Park Street for that, we just thought it'd be more fluid that, again, kept everything in a clockwise direction and one moving turn that the oversized delivery trucks,
right.
They utilize Park Street, it minimizes all those conflicts. If you start making zigzag turns, if I use this one, can't cross the front here, the situation still occurs. Try to get the right turn for CVS to work.
Yeah, they'll have to run.
It's going to put the building or it's going to put the parking and whatnot and
well,
create some friction with the other.
Most people don't realize that the driver has much better vision of his left side of his truck and where it's going than he does of the right. So he's got a better opportunity to make a clean turn, making that left-hand turn coming in from the curb cut. So that's the last item that's on that. So what I'm going to do now is open it to the public for a question and comment. Please state your name and address when you before you ask a question, and direct all questions to the chair. So do I have any questions or comments? I hope that what we did leading up to this answered as many of the questions as we could as possible for you. So do you have any questions? Yes, ma'am. We will have an erosion control barrier around the perimeter of the property, yes. It won't be hay bales, what now is it's a compost. It's a mulch and sock, and it's biodegradable and whatnot. So at the end of construction, what we do is we cut, if it doesn't break down, if the sheeting doesn't break down, it's cut and the mulch is just spread along the
So to be clear on the fencing, the 8-foot sound area fence is now going to be where the old stockade fence is.
It's going to be closer. It's going to be a foot onto John's property. And that 8-foot sound barrier fence will be 1 foot inside John Lucci's property. And it will run the entire length of from 3, right now the plan shows from 3 to 17.
Okay, is it going to come around 3 to cover 357?
That's what we need to
Sorry, ma'am, you have to state your name.
Kathleen Stegall, 57 Park Street.
Okay.
And we had a neighborhood meeting, and at that meeting, he had assured us that the fence would come down to behind 357 Park. And it's not on the plans now.
Yep, acknowledged. And I've heard a couple of comments, and we'll go back and evaluate it as it later on.
Okay, any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
Janice Brown, 50, Burnett Group. Yep. I was wondering if you determine what the sound barrier fences will be made of.
Yeah, it's a wood product. It's going to be 8-foot sections along the entire 4x4 pressure treated post. On the resident side, it's a 1x6 pine board. It'll be a 2x4, two rows of 2x4s on the back side, and in between the 2x4s is going to be a 2-inch foam panel insulation, and then that will be covered with a sheeting of plywood.
So it's going to absorb more sun than the regular line.
Right, and then what you'll have is you'll have, if your back is towards the plaza, if your back is towards the plaza and you're looking towards the residence, towards your own backyard, what you'll see is you'll have a driveway, then you're going to have a staggered row of evergreen trees, and then you're going to have an 8-foot high noise attenuation fence.
Can I do one more question?
Sure.
On top of the, where they're going to add on to that bump out, the existing CVS where they're going to put the liquor store in, Why do they have to
bump that open? The space right now is currently too small to accommodate the needs for the liquor store. So they need to expand.
So is that going to bump out as much as the back wall does to the left of that if you're looking from this direction? The existing building behind AutoZone sticks out further towards the back of, like, to my property?
The new CVS.
No, the old.
That's the new CVS.
The existing building.
You
know what
existing?
Existing
building.
The yellow building.
Yes. If I understand your question correctly,
go ahead.
Is the, there will be an addition out the back of the existing building by 32 feet. So it's going to be, there's going to be a piece of a building, 30 by 90, that's closer to the property line than it is today.
Is it, will that make up level more? Oh, it's still going to be further than the bump out? Then how are they going to go through them? How are the vehicles going to fit through them?
Well, we have an access drive that may be obstructed. So
24 feet.
Delivery trucks will have this whole access drive in here to travel. The receiving area for liquor store is inboard along this side of the building, so the delivery truck will travel in the north, back into the space right here, but this would be unimpeded access. In other words, there'd be no conflicts,
so
the open drive
back
in
where it's going to be, right, so that's, yeah, that's right. My truck, yeah.
It's a little,
are they
going
to leave the tractor trailers back in there?
I don't know too much of it.
Well, they have a down ramp that they back into. Now.
Right.
And
they have a trailer back there. I'm not sure what the final operation
and
is.
And are they going to sit all day long and, can there be something done?
I
have trucks running.
Well, that's something that we can control. That's an operational issue that again, the joint of the owner can mandate for the liquor store manager that when trucks come in to deliver product, they
just there.
But if you get any attempts, that's an operational issue that can be dealt with between John and specific tenants. One-on-one saying, when you have deliveries, shut down your
Well, it's not even just the noise of what's going to run, it's like stuff.
Yes, understood.
Well, they actually, in this state, there's an anti-idling law. They're not supposed to idle for more than 5 minutes. So if there is a noise complaint, the police department will come down and do something about it.
You said they're going to tie in the septic to the existing one temporarily?
Yes.
Do you know how long that would be for? Because don't they have problems with the existing septic in that CVS?
I am not aware of any septic system issues at the site. We did do soil testing for the location where the CVS is going. Long story short, it's excellent material. It's like beach sand. The water can't be held in the hole.
My question was, how long will they be tied in?
No, approximately 4 months. A four-month duration.
And they don't have to replace the existing one for the other property, even though they're...
No, the existing system, as we understand it and has been inspected, is functioning as designed.
I thought they had problems.
No. I'm not aware of any problems.
Okay, does anybody else have any questions? Gentleman in the back.
Tom Slumming, 9 Bridget Road. My concern is with the delivery truck transport. You've addressed pretty much everything coming around with the CVS back at CVS 30 years. You have one more minor problem, and that would be the AutoZone store. They deliver right at that corner between the two buildings. If I may. They deliver right here, and it's a trailer truck every time. With all due respect, sir, CVS can have their FedEx and UPS trucks deliver here. This is like the store. These are big trailer trucks that come around here.
Right.
Okay, they come around this way, that's fine. They exit which way from here?
They're exiting from around this way, and down this way.
And out through here?
Yes.
And Mr. Pierce, your concern was having this backed up, et cetera, here?
Yeah, actually,
with a trailer truck coming down through here, it's going to be a disaster. Just pointing out.
Who's the other one, Tom?
I believe the comment was.
Was that one?
Well, they can exit here too. And if you don't think they're going to cut through here to go this way, go north, that's great. They will, regardless. My other concern would be, this is great and everything else, where are you going to put the snow?
We have snow designated areas on the plan. Again, the plan would be to store some of the snow in this area, but not push it all the way down back.
Right. Okay.
There will also be snow storage along the end caps here, and at the end to be parking roads. And during the winter, the activity at the center typically is light, so we keep it remote.
Right. The other thing is, a lot of these stores, for instance, Mario's doesn't close until 11, if I'm not mistaken. So the employees get to these dumpsters, that's going to be quite a trip for them to get down around here. The trucks are there sometimes at 5:30 in the morning.
Yep.
We live right behind there, but at 5:30 in the morning, I think I'm back. To police that, you call the police. By the time they come and everything else, it's pretty much taken care of. I mean, we don't want to be calling the police every 15 minutes or every hour or whatever. You know, they really have enough to do. So as far as the truck patents are concerned, that's fine. It's just that that's going to be difficult. It's going to be very noisy, and the traffic patterns are going to be tough. They're going to be real tough.
Well,
who's to say a truck's not going to go in on?
Exactly. Even with signage, they're not going
to. Well, I think the signage is an important part of it, and that point was made. The signage, but I also think that because this redevelopment is happening of this property, it gives us an opportunity to address the issues you're bringing up. Otherwise, you would have no forum for it. So we're going to take advantage of this to try to talk to the owner and see if we can't make sure that the scheduled deliveries are done in such a way that don't impact you, because now we know about it, which we didn't really know before.
In addition to that, the dumpsters sometimes, when I worked at the fire department in Somerville, I was up sometimes at 5 o'clock in the morning. At 5:15, they were over there banging the dumpsters. It was crazy. I actually went over and told them, you can't do this, you're not supposed to be 7 o'clock.
Yeah, we've run into that before in other places and solved that problem, and the complaints went away. So again, this is an opportunity for us to ask that those things, because sometimes John may not even know what the schedules are for those, because he's dealing with other things, and the owners of these companies, these businesses that are here, are dealing with their dumpster guy. We just have to make sure the communication goes all the way through, so they know that their dumpster guy can't come at 5 in the morning. He's got to come at 7 or later. Right. So this is the opportunity. So it's been brought up. It's on record. We have it recorded. And we'll make sure, and give us an opportunity to make sure something, some kind of a schedule is adhered to.
Everybody that's here from the neighborhood, we're not against progress and making a profit and everything else. But Gene, at what cost?
Well, you know, again,
our quality of life has changed. Most of us have been here for a long time.
Yep.
And we moved away from someplace that was a lot more urban than what's happening here.
Right.
So just let you know.
Well, that's why we're having this meeting. That's why we're trying to address these things. John, you had a comment?
Please. I just wanted the neighbors to know that we did send letters, receipt requested from every one of the tenants notifying the town ordinances with regard to deliveries and with trash pickups. And also, we took care of Eastgate, and I wanted to make sure our people were at the same time. In addition, you know, we posted the signs, but the signs only mean so much. But the owners of each one of these stores need to know when they can get deliveries and that there are neighbors. We have to be aware of their neighbors.
Yep. So as you can see, there's a response already to this. He's already beginning to deal with it. So basically, if something happens that's not right, if you let him know, he will go to that particular owner and say you're not adhering to the rules. So you'll have it from both ends. So thank you, John, for that.
We do have his phone number.
Okay. Okay, anybody else have any comments or questions on this?
Janice Brown, 15 Burnett. When you were talking about the traffic, where the dumpsters are now and going. A few days ago, there was like, after the snowstorm, big CVS truck, the trailer behind that, and 3 food trucks at the same time trying to go to Mario's, and you got one coming, and they're all in there trying to get in and they can't, and they're backing up and turning around, and it was like this big traffic jam, because my yard's right behind me.
Well, it's 24 feet wide there back there, which is basically wide enough for the two trucks to pass each other. Now, the only thing that would inhibit the dumpsters aren't a problem, but the snow, if the snow wasn't properly removed, but that would be a temporary situation. Just like you wouldn't want to be driving on the highways when they get 3 or 4 inches of snow there, because you're going to have an accident, so you stay off, and that would be dealt with in a reasonable amount of time generally. So.
But no, my point, I guess, is if they're going to make it more narrow, rather than and people don't go in the direction they're going to go in, they're going to be...
I think there's probably going to be a point of education where the delivery people are educated by the stores that they're delivering to, that they need to adhere to these particular traffic patterns, and I think that will happen, and once they get it, they'll get it. So they're going to get regular deliveries from the same people all the time, and so once they get it, they'll get it. It's like any new traffic pattern. Have you been to the Rotary down in Wakefield?
Yeah.
Anyway, how long do you think it's going to take us to get that one right?
Yeah, that's clearly a good example.
Yeah, okay, but what I think this is much simpler than that, and I think you'll get it much
quicker. It just
needs
to be adjusted.
Steve, go ahead.
Because they weren't thinking.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a couple of comments.
Steve O'Leary, Board of Selectmen.
Just a couple of comments and questions. First of all, I want to acknowledge Mr. Lucci and CBS and all the team for their willingness to meet with the neighborhoods earlier on and subsequently to address the issues sooner rather than later. And I think a pretty good job here. But my question to some of the letters earlier meeting, it was some people were under the impression that there were going to be basically two fences, you know, one the sound fence up high behind the building, and then the lower one would be either replaced or maintained with some plantings in between. Apparently that's not going to be the case now.
It was looked at.
Are the neighbors okay with what the proposal was? As far as an 8-foot fence is pretty good. Again, that was a great proposal as far as site sound. But there was a certain comfort level as far as the dual fencing from a rodent control standpoint and additional sound barriers. But if that's not going to happen, are the neighbors okay with what's being proposed? I mean, is there not quite plantings?
I like the idea of the two fencings and then the description of the trees in between. It just sounded perfect. But if it's not feasible, you know, with all the digging, I can understand that.
Could you say your name for the record, please?
Mike Dozine, Tiger Network.
Okay.
When we originally talked about this, did have the two fence situation. The high stockade fence, the 8-foot, was going to be up on a higher elevation at that time. Now it's now it's coming back down to where.
Yes.
The discussion that we had was we were looking at the feasibility of trying to, since we had an existing fence already in place, we're trying to maintain and keep it, and then we would have the noise barrier fence a couple feet off the curb line.
Right.
That was the original discussions that we had when we were looking into and evaluating the feasibility. The more they started putting means to methods to construction, I quickly came to the conclusion that where the trees had to come down and be cut and the roots had the stumps have to be pulled, that's going to pull the fence down.
What was originally talked about is the east, how about the height elevation that we can go where the building is, the parking area. How much further down? What's the drop in the elevation? Fencing from the 8-foot being right 2 feet off the curb as opposed to where you're proposing. It's probably a 3 or 4 foot drop, right?
There is a 4 foot drop between. There's a 4 foot elevation drop between the grade here and the grade of the
park. All right, so your 8-foot fence is really going to drop 4 feet from what was originally talked about at the neighborhood meeting.
Right.
We didn't talk about an 8-foot fence at the neighborhood meeting. We talked about two fences to maintain the
space.
We're talking about headlight, we're talking about deliveries, we're talking about light from the building, and again, which would allow for some lighting on the back of the building, which doesn't currently exist, which is safety for employees and deliveries. We're talking 8-foot fence. Standpoint, that would have been pretty satisfying. So now, as you're dropping it down 4 feet, the impact of it is minimized for both the sound and the visibility standpoint. I'm just putting this up based upon my recollection of the meeting. Whatever works, whatever's agreed upon,
again, from a rodent standpoint, over the years they've had a problem, less of a problem lately, but significant problem. They just thought 2 yards is better than one, as well as sound barriers, trees with sound barriers, and two fences. So if you're going to drop this thing down 4 feet, you know, basically what you have is a 4 foot barrier from the firm.
Four feet less.
I think he's
so,
concrete.
The curbs are too close.
So, are they satisfied?
Oh,
I'd
have to listen to you. Yeah.
Thank God.
I know he was going to screw that right up.
Significant difference in elevation from the 2 feet off the curb cut down to where the existing fence is. You're now talking about putting this new fence, 8 foot fence, where the existing fence is. So right now they have what, the six foot? They're going to pick up 2 feet.
If I said 8 foot,
right? That big
house? We're going to look at
2 feet. You're picking up 2 feet from what currently exists, but significantly less than what was talked about, proposed, and considered.
Yeah, it was discussed.
Discussed and considered.
Yeah. The more we get into it, the
right. Again,
it's
logic. So if you were to take a look at what we had discussed, putting the 8 foot fence 2 feet off the curb, and what we discussed that night too was snow removal. Part of the snow removal process in the back of the building, you did have to move it away. But now what you're doing is providing yourself more opportunity to clear the area behind the building in between there and where the new fence is being proposed. But you were talking about removing, snow removal, just taking it out from being on the building and putting it out front.
That's correct.
That's not what you're proposing now.
Correct. Right.
So if you were to go back to what was discussed and go with an 8 foot fence 2 feet off the curb, and you have a snow removal issue, but you'd also have a more significant barrier for these people. Put your plantings in. If you don't want to go with the second fence, it would certainly be here so they would expand their backyard a little bit more. To enjoy the foliage and the trees, the abrevieties they're just suggesting, as opposed to a second fence. That's just one.
Okay, to your point, you're absolutely correct, but the flip to that is, I guess my logic was, I was listening to the concerns of, during construction about children in the neighborhood trespassing. Yes, that if we decide that we want to relocate the noise barrier fence, being 3 feet off the back of the curb, you kind of created that situation where now there is no protection along that rear property line, all they've been trees.
But you're talking about a temporary fence there anyway.
For construction, that would be taken down. So I'm talking post-construction operations.
So we're talking post-construction, you're not playing under two fences, so maintaining the current fence and putting up the new one, as previously discussed. Mm-hmm. What you're talking about is moving the proposed down 4 feet.
Yes.
The impact of that is less significant for these people than what was originally discussed. From a safety standpoint, I would imagine that the temporary fence is going to be a temporary fence, but how it's going to go. And if the compromise is, what these people have to consider, is moving that proposed fence further east to the back of the building, up higher, a more significant impact on them, a positive impact. They just have the plantings without the second fence. You've got to decide which way you're going to go. You can't have it both ways necessarily.
No. I'm thrilled you brought that up, Steve.
So, again, I wasn't sure, based upon what I was hearing tonight, that everybody was visualizing what was being proposed and what the impact was.
They're right on top of the curve.
It's better than what they have.
It's
correct. Because it's 2 feet higher than what they have.
Correct.
It's a better quality fence from a soundproofing and protective standpoint, but it's not what was discussed.
No. So you're saying our backyards are going to be like wall back, abrevieties,
and
the fence.
You're going to have your backyard, your abrevieties, and the knoll going up to an 8 foot fence.
That's acceptable.
Okay.
be.
See, that's acceptable to him. So that's that's more acceptable to Michael. It probably, if you really think about it, probably most everybody.
But didn't you just say it wasn't going to be 8 feet?
It's still an 8-foot fence. It's just a question of where they planted it. It's either up here or 4 feet tall.
Okay, let's.
But the only other question I have, aside from the fence, was there going to be some sort of interaction between the developers and Mass Highway in relation to the traffic flow at the intersection?
Yeah, sure.
Has there been?
No. The primary reason for that is Mass Highway won't entertain a curb cut permit application until we secure our land use permits at the local level. So
we're also talking about maybe potentially some modifications from the intersection, which the state would have to get involved with based upon the development.
Right, that all gets started with a curb cut permit application, where we prepare an application, we submit our traffic report and our improvements, plan improvements to the curb cut. That goes into MassDOT, then that gets a review. That's where that evaluation process starts. But I can't start that process until I obtain a permits from the planning board on site plan review and the order of conditions from the conservation commission. We will not accept an application.
Thank you. I just want to clarify things for the commission's benefit as to where my impression was that we may be at and where we are today. And I wanted to get some sort of feedback from the neighbors as to did they understand that the same thing happens basically 4 foot shorter.
We kind of understand that.
Yeah. In the effect, better than what they have, but it isn't what was discussed. And I understand from an operational standpoint, it would be much easier from an operational standpoint to have more room behind the buildings and move some snow around, you know, for the 2-3 months you need it. And the impact of the neighborhood was really discussed, and the impact was concerns were expressed and considered.
Hey, Warren.
Go ahead, Chris.
Mr. Salemi actually seems to have a good thought about coming around the north end of the building there. I'm looking at your roadway in the truck route. You're gonna jump the end island, that concrete end there. And same when you come back up, you're going to jump another one right at a light, actually, one of your roadway lights.
That's the ladder truck, though. That's the ladder truck, that is.
Well, the ladder truck in a 53-foot truck doesn't run any better. I'm on C16.
You have a 22-foot truck in a 53-foot box. That's a long truck.
Those are striped. Or one to make it safe for them.
We can look at that.
I'm just, you know, you had a good point, so yep. I looked at it again. Coming out of there was the question because it's kind of narrow right there.
Yeah, there's a pinch point right at the current at the corner. That's
right.
Right. Okay. All right. I didn't realize it was just striping. I thought it was raised concrete.
No. So
ends. Okay.
Excuse me, Mr. Jim. Just in relation to the lighting of the back of the building, you know, you were talking about maybe putting a 7-foot height. I was assuming that
it should be a post, that's all.
Visual,
I guess the only point I don't have to have is twofold. One is that the optics of the LEDs are recessed within the fixture itself, so you won't be seeing the actual light fixture or bulbs themselves. That light will be directed downward. And number two is we do have a staggered row of arborvitaes before the fence that will again enhance screening of these wall packs. And I don't envision any, I mean, we have three along CVS, you probably have six along the total back of the other store. And we can position the trees such that to maximize those that screening of those fixtures in those areas such that there is no impact to the neighbors. And should there be, you know, at the end when the planting is finished and there is a gap, we can always add, you know, additional landscape opportunities to further enhance but and reposition those so that we gain maximum coverage and deflection screening of those fixtures from the residents.
I apologize, Mr. Chairman, but how far off from the curb are the plantings proposed?
We have a 25-foot landscape buffer, so we have that total 25 feet to work with.
You also have to leave some room for bushes. No.
Well, there'll be a 5-foot, there's going to be, you know, a 5-foot shelf along, a 5-foot flat area to handle guardrail and hydrant installation type work, and then the area will be graded down off. But the trees can be planted within that sloped area. It will just maximize stepping there. Right.
So what's the rate of slope on the back there? In other words, if you wanted to, what would be the possibility of getting that fence higher up the hill?
Well, it becomes a challenge with a wooden fence up, you know, anything greater than 8 feet from a logistical standpoint. You're dealing with deep foundations and wind load and everything else. It becomes really more of a problem to try to engineer and design something that's going to be stable during those high wind events. But the grading itself we have a 3-to-1, we have a 5-foot, you know, shoulder, if you will, on the back, and then it grades down at 3-to-1 to maintain a flat area as much as we can along the residential water's area, because that acts as collecting the water that runs off that landscape slope we have channelized to bring it to the wetland area so it does not go on to the bike front.
So what would be the problem with putting the 8-foot fence right at the very back of the 5-foot flat area?
It can be moved to the fence will probably have to be segmented. And what I mean by that is, again, from roughly this point on, the existing basin, there's no construction work going on. So if we're going to commit to taking care of 17 and 15 and potentially 13 Burden Road, my proposal would be to have the noise attenuation fence be installed along the rear property line and then have a break. Then we could come up along this area and have it 5 feet off. And then we would have the landscaping trees behind that.
Right.
The only...
And perhaps landscaping trees in the break.
Yes, and we'll...
But then they can get it. Then they can get access. Then they can get access.
Then you get access. So we're clear. Then there is, again, post-construction. After all construction is done, then there is no fencing along the rear property line where we move the noise barrier fence to be 5 feet off the edge of the pit. And to address...
Well, correct me if I'm wrong, but doesn't that area all just grow in? I mean...
It'll grow up. I mean, again, we're cutting it down, so yeah, the outer bodies are going to grow as we moved to before, 2 to 4 feet every time. So yeah, it's going to come back. I was just listening. The biggest takeaway that I got from the last meeting was during construction is there was concern about children from the neighborhood cutting through the shopping center. I just took that one step further, not only after construction, but while we're in operation, so I just wanted to mix that.
But if you put the temporary chain link in, you know, that you just drop in and then you take back out, that pretty much solves that problem.
What he's talking about, Warren, I think, is when construction's all finished,
yep,
the kids could still cut through their backyards, and maybe they do now. Do they?
Do you really care?
They jump the 6-foot fence, they walk along that cement thing, and they go over to CVS. So at least the younger, years ago, the younger crowd did.
So keeps them off the main street. I mean.
Yeah, but it's the pass, too. It's the pass,
yeah.
So you're going to have the pets going right into the arborvitaes in your own backyard.
Just leave it alone, Mark.
I like the idea of the two fences with the arborvitaes in between. And I don't know why you're not considering putting the continuation of the beautiful fencing along Kingston. It's going to make the whole property look nice, all the same.
Of course. It's cost.
I know.
I think there's a reasonable level here. The if the plantings are fairly close to the property line, that's going to be, as far as screening and buffering, that will buffer the fence. You won't see the fence. But I think the fence. So I think that the fence need to, if the fence is up 5 feet off the curb line, then you have the full benefit of that noise blocking fence, which you don't have now. So Steve's right, you're gonna, and no matter what happens, you're gonna end up with more than what you got as a result of this. So there's, you know, you have to keep that in mind. But I think that if you did that you'd have that full fence, and that would certainly screen lighting as well as everything else. I don't know what a second fence does for you down there.
It was to cover the property.
Well, you'd have the plantings there.
An ugly, crappy temporary that we can see through.
Yeah,
well, after the temporary is gone, we're going to be seeing arborvitaes.
Right. Yeah, you're going to see the arborvitaes in the trees.
You're going to see woods.
And then everything else is going to grow back
exactly.
In.
Exactly. I'd rather see
woods.
You don't want to lose
those. Well, they're going to put them back, and then they're going to let them grow. It'll go back to wild, but.
Yeah.
It'll go pretty quick.
It will. But those Tahula Green Giants, they do grow very quickly.
I'm not sure what he meant by that space in the future.
I live right behind the building.
Okay, could you state your name, please, for the record?
Lucille Austin, 7th Burnett Road. Thank you. I live behind
the liquor
store, okay? I've grown my arborvitaes, which is right at the end of the property line, for 20 years. They're bigger than this ceiling.
Yeah.
Don't you touch them.
Oh, yeah, you know the lines are. She doesn't want you to touch their trees.
Everybody wants my trees.
They are beautiful.
Okay, hold on here. Go ahead.
If I may. I just need a little direction on the fencing at the back. And I know there's a lot of one way or another. If a decision is made to have the noise barrier fencing 5 feet off the edge of the pavement, I'm more than happy to do that. A couple things that need to be considered. One is, I mentioned that there's going to be a break in that continuation line that will probably overlap in this area.
Yeah,
the sole reason of, we're not doing any work over here, we're not disturbing any soil. So to go in and to cut existing vegetation to put up a fence just doesn't make a lot of sense to me in that. We can leave the natural barrier and the buffer there. If there is noise coming from this area, then I think what we need to do is police it on site. Understand what the issue is, understand what the complaint is,
yep,
from these neighbors, and then be proactive in addressing it.
Well, I would say that if you're not getting a lot of complaints from that side right now, there's no real change happening on the building on that end, so you're not probably going to get it in the future.
That is correct. And I'm just hearing it from the residents, and we haven't heard anything from
that side.
Right. If I put the noise barrier fence 5 feet off, just so we're all clear, is when I make the return on the CVS side where it has the parking, is the woman that lives at 367 Park Street, she's not going to get that noise barrier fence along the property. She'll get it 5 feet off.
She's saying that's okay.
Okay. Just so we're clear. So yeah. If I can get some direction on where the fence is preferred, I'll make the change. I believe
that in order to stay true to what the people believe was going to happen, you need to keep it at least 5 feet, approximately
keep
5 feet off.
Keep it as high as you can.
And because I don't, because again, if you go further than that, you start down the hill and you begin to lose the effect of the height. So I'd say you that if that's a, fair, a reasonably level area, that 5 feet back, then then at that point I would say the barrier, the noise barrier fence needs to go. And then the plantings could go behind that. And as far as another fence, I don't know, that's, you know, I don't, I agree, I can, again, I agree with Steve on this, that, those plantings are going to take the place of that fence and everything will grow in natural again. Just even if you put a wooden fence there, it's going to, everything's going to grow up around it and you're not going to, it's just going to grow back in natural. So it's not really going to give you any real benefit, I don't believe.
And that's, I guess, the piece that I want to close out with. Is it,
I think that's the, I think that's
really what, no two fences, because again, I don't see the, I don't, I think the evergreen plantings will be, will complement the second fence that was planted.
Yeah, I don't think they realize how much benefit they'll get from the 8-foot fence at this point. That there'll be nothing to see, and so all you have is the green. You won't even, everything will grow in.
Okay.
So the second fence may be, actually may be more of a problem than it is a benefit in the end, because trying to take care of it, work around it, you have to keep cutting the green down to work on it. That doesn't make any sense. So I believe that's what I believe would be the best, and as long as there seem to be some level of agreement on that, so I think maybe that's how you should go.
I will revise the plan.
Mr. Chairman, just in relation to the break in the fencing, the step down, I don't know what number, Burnett.
Probably at 13.
Right.
What does that mean?
Even a, and again, this is more for critter control and also comfort for kids. You know, even if it's not going to be a soundproof fence, but some sort of a chain link fence connecting the two, I think would probably be wise from a safety standpoint, cutting through.
You're talking about
well, basically, it's just
after
a fence there, so there'd be no.
Is it after construction or during construction?
After.
No,
construction. Okay, that just.
No, I think yeah. No, I know.
Okay.
During construction. I guess.
Yeah, you're gonna have a whole chain link fence in there. Yeah.
So there will be a fence all the way across. It'll overlap in the back, and then there'll be just something between here in order to keep any kids or anything from going through.
Kids and critters.
Yes, ma'am. You have a question.
15 Burnett, Janice Brown, the break that ends at 13. What is up with 15 and 17?
With a soundproof fence down closer along the line, right along the line.
But
down.
With more foliage that's already there.
In the backyard.
Go ahead.
Okay, because you kept saying a break and it ends at.
But the break isn't like this. The break is like this. The break is here. So the fence is here and the fence is here. And there's going to be, because of the elevation change.
But it'll be blocked.
It'll be,
no,
yes.
Okay.
It'll be,
I was
yes.
Just like, I'm not going to
yeah.
get a parenthesis.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mrs. Bryant, the way it's going to work on your piece of the property is that you have the existing drainage basin that's not being disturbed.
Yes.
The proposal is to install the noise fence 1 feet off of your rear property. So it from 17 Bird Road, which is the Forestall family, and the Brown family, and roughly, again, so I get out the plant halfway through the Lally family, that noise fence will be 1 foot off your rear property. Okay? Then it's gonna get picked up again.
Okay, I understand.
Okay. So just so clear, that's that gap. Now, if I understand the gap, when we have the overlap in here, there's a proposal to put chain link to cut that gap up.
Yeah, something that keeps kids and so forth from going through there.
So the animals and stuff.
Yeah.
If it's offensive, it's going to be tough for the animals.
That's what I said.
No, they don't want, they're talking about domesticated animals.
And not domesticated.
Yeah.
Well, the non-domesticated won't be able to get through either, but the little things will.
Okay. Now that we've done with it, any further questions on any other part of the plan here now?
Good. We have a couple other things to talk about.
You do?
We do.
I
the signs.
Oh, yeah, no, we're going to do a separate sign there.
Not as late as they want to do it.
Okay.
I don't agree with that.
Okay, if you don't state your name, then the recorder, who cannot see you or identify you by face because it has no camera, you must state your name for the record so that we can do a proper and accurate a proper and accurate recording of this session. So.
Well, I just said Nancy Amoroso, 9 Burdett. I just said the plans show Fraser Furs around the dumpster pads out here to the right. And I said, do you think it's a good idea to put Fraser around the dumpsters? I mean, the animals can climb up the trees and get down into the dumpster. I don't think trees around a dumpster is a good idea. That's just my opinion.
I've seen it happen. So.
And push her back, Father.
Yeah, if you're making it pretty, make it pretty, but maybe keep a little distance.
A little more distance, yeah.
All right, yes, sir, something new?
Just got one question about you said the trash compactor is going to be moved to the other side of the building?
Yes, no trash compactor.
CDF building?
Yes.
Compactor and dumpster that's external. We took it from attached to the building and relocated to be separate from the building, so it's going to be screened in an enclosure with access gates to it, similar to what we're doing proposing on the opposite end of the property.
Where is it proposed on that?
The CVS dumpster and compact is in this location right here. What we're going to do for the small store strip that's staying is combine all the dumpsters in one location, which is located in here.
You think they're going to go all the way over there?
They're going to have to.
Okay. Okay, so now the only one question we have to deal with right now is the question about the signs, about a separate sign package. Are we okay with a separate sign package for them?
That's something we do pretty frequently. They can either submit it all together as part of the site plan review approval, or they can do it after the fact.
Yeah, I was going to say we've done this a number of times. We just did it with Stop and Shop up here with that thing there. We did a whole separate sign package for them, and they did their improvements.
Warren, I don't mind having a separate sign package, but quickly, not getting it by occupancy, because if whatever they do with the signs, they've already put holes in their walls, and they've got electric there, and then they come in and say, oh, we can't change it now. So I agree getting it in so they can get their construction started, but before the building permit. They should have plenty of time for that.
That may be tough to do, listen.
I'm waiting.
Okay. My longest permit timeline is my mass DOT curb cut. It's going to be 4 to 6 months.
Right. I'm not saying the sign package now.
Let him finish.
I'm sorry.
So what I would like to be able to do is be able to start on-site construction. And be able to get, because there's a lot of infrastructure that needs to be relocated to build the CVS pad. There's gas work, electric work, telephone, the whole nine yards. I'd like to be able to get under construction site-wise so that I can get that stuff moved, get a pad built.
You misunderstood me. Building permit, not foundation and not site work. So you can get all that started. I'm okay with that. But before the building permit is pulled, before you're final on the building, we have the signs taken care of. So we're talking 4 to 6, you said 4 to 6 weeks here, and then, you know, you've got time. I don't think the sign package is going to hold you up, right?
Well, go ahead. CVS. So if the town provides foundation permits separate from building permit?
They always do. You get a foundation permit before you get a, well, you can get a foundation permit before you get a building permit.
Sometimes just give you just the full building permit.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah,
so
some do, but
product foundation, that's fine. Not a problem.
You know, the foundation's going to be the foundation. It's once you start building the walls, you don't want to change anything. Though I did see that incorrect elevation you put. I kind of like that sign. On the sign, on the plan package?
The plan, yeah. You have the wrong front elevation.
You put the wrong elevation in there?
It's okay.
It's the wrong building, but I like that sign.
Yeah, I let you guys know that.
I like that sign much better than the other signs.
Oh, God. There we go.
So to get back onto signage for a minute, as you've heard from the CVS representative, should the planning board vote to approve the project, then we would accept the condition of a private building permit with the understanding that a foundation permit could be issued to at least get the building stuff worked.
I mean, we could check that, right, Daniel? We could talk to
whether you could get a foundation permit first.
Yeah.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, I mean, we've done. I know residentials. He does that all the time.
Yeah.
And I think for commercial too.
I don't think so much for residential, but commercial, it's not an unusual request.
Yeah, that's something that's done. But we can.
Yeah.
Sure.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Let's check. Make sure.
Okay.
I'm not trying to hold the project up. I just want to make sure that. You know.
No, I understand. I understand. I'm just trying to work some logistics because I'm on fly.
Well,
what
we don't want is to have you come in and say, well, we've already put out, you know, we have to have the signs here because that's the way we've built it.
I totally understand where you're going. I'm just trying to work with you and try to come to a happy medium. If you understand my part, I understand your part. We can just come to a
The fire. The Firestone store kind of did that to us.
I'm not looking to do any of that, but
okay.
You know, if you're saying we can confirm that the building inspector will issue a foundation permit.
That's
fine. Yeah,
I don't think there's a problem with that.
Okay.
I think he'll
do that.
Yeah, he's pretty good about making sure things.
And we got a bank. We got a bank foundation up here. Doesn't have a bank on it for 15
I don't
years.
I doubt that would be an issue, but I will check.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, I think we can, if we're all set, if there are no more questions or comments, then I'm going to close the public hearing.
Updating the facade.
Would we reopen it for the signs?
No, I think that would be separate. I mean, I would think that we would, depends how we want to handle it. Because this is a plaza, it needs a master plan for signage. I don't think we'd want to reopen a public hearing
open a new one for it.
I don't know how we normally would.
Well, if everything you're doing fits within the four corners of the law, then there's no problem. Building inspector is approving, final approving authority.
Right, that's true. I think this board would want to request to see it, though. I mean, I think they could probably just get sign permits, but
But let's have a look at them anyway, and then in case there are any variances whatsoever that are required, we can take care of it at that time. So we'll entertain a separate sign package. Okay, that's what we'll do. And so what I'm going to do is close the public hearing on this section of it.
Okay.
And hearing no more questions or comments. You're going to make some changes on that plan. So we're going to wait, and when we get the changes that we've talked about on the plan, location of the fence and all those things, and then
the dumpsters.
I think if we're going to be waiting for a new plan to be submitted, it might be best to leave the public hearing open.
Okay.
Because if there's new information shown on that plan and discussion about it, it probably would.
Or anything different than what we've talked about tonight.
True.
If it's everything we talked about tonight, it's all set.
Right. Just if we wanted the flexibility of being able to make any further changes or suggestions or new information.
We can continue with that. I didn't know if I wanted to have people all come back just for nothing.
Sure.
That was all.
There's going to
be no changes.
Well,
have them all come back and say, guess what? No changes. Everything we said last time, that's what you get.
Well, they got some parking issues for you, Warren, and they got to look at that dumpster and give us some numbers on that, the back corner of the CVS dumpsters. And
all right, I guess I wonder, what's our next availability for them?
7.
Our next meeting is March 7th. I don't know how much time you
really
need.
We have 35 and
37
Main Street.
At
8 o'clock
that night? Okay.
That's 2 weeks, right?
That's 2 weeks.
Yeah.
I don't think we have anything on for the 21st yet.
You have nothing on the 21st yet?
I don't think we do. No, I'm not.
Well, let me...
Oh, do you know...
Let me take the March 7th.
Okay.
And I'll call you, Danielle, if it's a problem.
Sure.
The only thing that I will need to do is get the Florida Metrics Plan updated, and that's my long lead item. So I got to work with that gentleman to see what he can do for me. And if we get everything in, the site plan will be probably coming in on the 6th. Mm-hmm. And
okay.
But I'm giving you, if I know it's going to be longer than that, I'll let you know, and then we'll fall back to the 21st, is it?
Yeah, the 21st. Now, do you know when the subdivision?
Okay, then we're just gonna. That's okay. We'll continue it then until the 7th.
Okay. Till the 7th. That should we say if the first public hearing is on at 8 o'clock? Do we want to say?
Let's say
8:30.
What's our time frame on this approval?
I can draft a conditional approval for the next.
Well, I mean, time frame on the continuation of the public hearing. Do we have time still?
We have time.
Okay. Okay.
8:30.
8:30.
Yeah.
That'll do. Okay. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Even if the other one decides to, you know, or something. What's that?
Yeah. I'm starving. I think that's it. Dinner. Came from work.
Uh-oh.
I think I was actually thinking
about Mario's. Yes, go.
So,
are we still on TV?
Yep.
I've gotten a multitude of calls about the sign and check. Looking through our zoning.
Hey folks, can you take your conversations outside? We're still recording on the TV. Thanks.
So just looking at our signage bylaw that we have under prohibited signs, section 200-80. Number N states, neon signs or other directly lit signs are not permitted in residential districts and the local businesses and general business zoning districts. This parcel does lie within the residential district. And it is a town owned property, but it is under the residential district.
You got it on the recording. You want to replay it?
Bring the board.
Okay.
I'm recording.
So you don't think you should have that Google sign there, huh?
No.
That.
Well, it's not just the sign, it's the awnings, too.
Well, first, did they get a permit for it?
They did. So I talked to, they did get a permit for it through the
building inspector.
I did talk to the building inspector, and he did issue the permit. So, and the really only course of action is to, A, talk to the commission over at the Hillview, or appeal it. I mean, I've gotten a lot of phone calls on this just one topic. And I just have done some research.
Are they even open?
They are open.
Signs
lit every night.
It's an ugly sign.
It's a hideous
sign. You never see any cars there.
I don't know the status of the business. It's
true. Signs like people in if they don't feel
it's
that
open
right.
Yet.
Yeah, me either, because I never
shouldn't
see
even be on.
And I drive by it 100 times.
Don't forget your tripod.
But yeah, I kind of was surprised to see that sign show up.
No, leave it. We need a tripod.
So I don't know. I just wanted to bring that up because I have been getting a lot of phone calls. I don't want to put it in.
So what are our course of action? We can either appeal it.
Yeah.
Or
talk to the owners of the property.
And say what? And say what's wrong?
That, you know, the sign
we don't like your sign.
Ideally, yeah.
They're gonna say we got a permit for it.
That's that's where they all, you know, I mean.
And they're probably gonna say, and they probably spend 10 grand to buy the sign, so.
You got a lot of residents in town that don't like me being one of them.
Yeah, because it lights up that whole side of the street, that light does spill out across the street.
And it doesn't meet our bylaws, I mean, we have bylaws that we're voting on.
You know what, he's not new to the bylaws.
That's right.
He knows very well in residential districts that signs like that are not allowed, huh?
The building inspector or Teresa's?
Well, Teresa's, Nick knows exactly what the bylaw is.
So why did Jim give it to him?
I don't know, I have no idea.
Well, I actually.
What?
They're trying to make that place successful, is what the deal is, so I'm sure there, that the intent was to help the Hillview Commission, you know, move this whole project along. I'm sure, I believe they spent a bunch of money on the kitchen, you know, that they're trying to bring everything up to code and then, you know, have it be productive. So I'm sure that there was an attempt to bring it along, well-intentioned as it might have been.
But he,
but
both.
It does violate the bylaw.
He knows how negative people feel about signs because of the sign on.
That was one of the biggest battles we had.
Absolutely.
The sign is.
Absolutely. He's in a residential, you know, it's not like he's not in residential here.
We went to quite a lot of that.
I mean, me personally, I don't mind having a sign. Definitely do it in other ways.
Yeah.
Definitely a sign that fits the building.
It's just hard to go back to someone after they spent a ton of money and got a permit from the building inspector.
Well, yeah.
It's like if he had said, hey, you got to go to site plan review, and then we talked to him and we analyzed the sign and we changed it and we modified it and made it. Because I agree, it doesn't fit. It doesn't even fit the style of building.
No.
Like,
no.
That requires an externally lit, carved, you know, wood sign or something.
Yeah, absolutely. Just like they got a Ryers.
Neon sign. Just like Ryers, exactly. But it doesn't fit the building. But the problem is that our town official, who's supposed to be our police on signs, already gave him a permit. The guy already spent a ton of money. I agree. Doesn't mean that it's right. But it's hard to go back to someone after they said, well, we asked permission, we paid our permit, and we got it.
Yeah.
It's kind of hard to go back.
Doesn't fit the Red Hill Inn.
No, the sign doesn't fit. I agree.
It does. I don't know.
What's that? Oh, yeah. There's a ton of people that are unhappy about it.
I don't like it personally. But I wish.
There's a fairly dense neighborhood right across the street from it.
Yeah, the people that are getting that are actually getting abused by it.
You can't miss it.
So, yeah, I mean, the people that are getting abused by it. Getting
the biggest
license.
Thing, too, now is now you got, you know, maybe Moose, oh, look at that, they got that signage. Let me go get some word-lit signage over here. It could snowball down, and then, you know, you get a couple other businesses right there. To me, it doesn't, it's
he's
a violation of the bylaw.
He's also got a lot of words on his awnings now. He's got more awnings up now than he did before, right? Yeah, the front entry is no longer the Hillview, it says Teresa's on it. And
I do get what they're doing over there. They are
trying to make something out of nothing.
But there's other ways.
It's the wrong time of the season, though.
It is the wrong time of the season.
You got to get the golfers in there, and then they'll come back in the wintertime.
But I wish.
Yes.
Jim had brought it up before.
Absolutely.
Now it's just very hard for us to go back and totally appeal the guy. He's trying to do something with the town-owned property that is hard.
And it seems to make it something.
So,
it seems to have gone up after I think the Hillview was meeting anymore.
And there's no way to just, you can't go in and like tweak the sign. It's like, it's just gotta.
Yep.
It's gotta go. So it's, we either gotta really fight it and appeal it.
So when you talk to Jim
and tell him to leave,
get out to him, what did he say?
I have to appeal my decision and talk to them.
And we're gonna talk to them and they're gonna say, we got a permit, so appeal us.
Yeah.
They're not gonna go, they already spent the money. He can't make a change to it.
No.
So we either got to make a decision to go fight it or let it be.
I mean, I'd be fine with shutting off and not even lighting the thing. Because now that isn't violating our bylaw.
And he's not going to do that because that defeats the whole purpose.
You
might as well not have
light
a sign.
On the ground that shines on it.
It's directly lit signs are, I mean, it's. I mean, just picture like across your house is across the street from there, and every night. That's blowing into your room. I mean, that's the way I look at stuff like that. I mean, I have to look at it from the person that calls me up and explains everything to me.
How long has the sign been up for?
Well, a month at least.
Months, yeah.
A month and a half.
It was there before I went away.
It was put up about the third week of January.
I know it was brought up at a selectman meeting.
It's brought up at a selectman's meeting. It's been brought up at the historical commission meeting.
Nobody's spoken to them yet about it?
About who?
Nobody's spoken to Frank.
To Nick?
I know I've talked to Mr. O'Leary, because I know he's the liaison with that boy that went. It's just hoping to see him afterwards.
The guy from Teresa's is going to say, I got a permit. Fight me on it. So we.
I don't think the Hillview's meeting right now.
We got to go one way or another. We either fight it or we leave it.
I mean, I personally would like to talk, at least talk to them and see.
But what are his options? He doesn't have any.
There's always options.
Yeah, take it down.
Yeah. That's an option.
Well, here's, there is an option, okay?
Yeah, turn it off.
No, hang on. The question would be whether or not the Hillview Commission approved this, knew that this was happening, and approved this sign. So I think that what we do initially is appeal to the commission to say, listen, it was issued in error. We don't really want to take the building inspector to task on it. This thing was put up in error. Would you help him with a replacement sign? So if Frank's going to get some help, Frank Yabba's going to get some help from it, getting something on it that is actually more acceptable, and the commission is willing
it'll
to
make
help.
It make him, yeah, it'll be easier to swallow.
Exactly. So I think that's the avenue.
What are the chances that he'd be fully commissioned?
Well, I mean, obviously they have a
sign.
Budget, and they have, and they have stuff, and they do okay. They had a good year last year, so they might have a little bit of discretionary funds they'd be willing to put into fixing something that was partly of, you know, that was.
They gave permission. It's definitely their.
They're the town people. It's a town committee, you know. This is something that's for the town, and the town made them, you know, obviously made an error, and we believe in issuing that permit. So why don't we get the town to work together to fix it?
Do you think they would fight us on it?
I think they would understand the bylaw, and I think that we might get some support there.
Okay.
And if we can get some support, and if they say, yeah, we'll support it, what's it going to cost? I don't know. Let's get Frank in on it now. Let's all sit down, try to put something together that makes rational sense. I think that's the way to approach it.
I don't want to
start bringing, you know, the buildings. You know,
no, I don't want either.
Yeah, well, we none of us want to, so that's why. So that's what
you're right.
You know, because this is all stuff for the town. So let's. So why don't we see if we can solve it within the town, and get the commission to realize that a mistake's been made here, and let's fix it.
Sounds like a plan.
That's probably the best plan.
It's the only plan.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you know, it really solves everything by saying, you know, everybody can make a meal.
Yeah, we messed up. Let's try to fix it.
Yeah. Let's fix it. So I guess what we would want to do, perhaps, is see if we can get somebody from the Hillview Commission to come to a meeting.
Yeah, I don't know if they're meeting right now.
That's okay. They're still around.
Well, they're still around. Some of them are. I know George isn't, because he's down south.
Who's on it?
George Stack is on it. But it was like he left on a Friday, and it was put up the next week. So.
I would assume that they were made aware that a sign was going to go there.
I'm hoping.
I think it would be done without their knowledge.
Yeah, no. Sure.
So they are a party to it. That's why I think we should bring them into it. And realizing the error, they may be willing to help support. So I don't know, do we want to bring them, or do we want one of us to go to their meeting? Or?
No, there's a meeting tomorrow night.
Is it?
There's a meeting tomorrow night, Hillview Commission.
I'll go with you. Call me.
149 North Street.
They have it at the Hillview.
At the Hillview, 7 p.m. Let's see, minutes, bills, review revenue and expenditures, new business.
There you go.
Discuss proposals for parking lot lights.
Yeah, that we probably ought to be involved in.
Yeah, and restriping the parking lot.
That's okay, we don't care about that.
Yeah, that we don't care about, but it's the other one you do.
Yes. Lights, they're going to have to be careful with the neighborhood. So.
Absolutely.
Well, good, Billy. That'd probably be a good idea for us to go.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
All right, so 7 p.m.
What time is that?
7 p.m.
Great.
I'll think of you.
Yeah, thanks.
I'll be.
Okay, is that it?
Like to make a motion to close the hearing?
Second.
Close the hearing?
No, adjourn the meeting.
Yeah, adjourn the meeting.
Don't worry about it.
Adjourn.
You can't even think, you're tired.